Fury, and Mauler.
What's the situation?
And Ryan.
Welcome and guys, Ryan.
Do another Stargrift. This is our last show until we conclude all of the seasons for the shows that are coming out. And then we'll do like a, you know, like a one-off episode recap. But yeah, welcome to the final episode of Stargrift. So What's up, boys?
The final one. You know what they say, though? No one's ever really gone. I mean, this is a Star Wars show, after all.
Right.
It's pretty much everyone.
Damn right.
The best, always quote.
They have really taken that as their mantra, I feel like, at Lucasfilm. No one's ever really gone, especially if they're a female character. So.
Yeah.
You know, in retrospect, there's such a troll in it that they put that in the trailer for Rise of Skywalker, and then you hear the Palpatine laughing, and you're like, are you fucking kidding? Like, what are you doing? And they're like, it makes sense.
Do you guys remember that Rise of Skywalker? I think it was like Rent a Palpatine. Where he's like, let the battle begin in that trailer.
Rent a Palpatine.
Never said Rent. That.
Well, yeah, like that happens with a lot of trailers that end up like they end up cutting a couple things for the final cut.
No, it wasn't even Palpatine. It was like some dude with a really bad impersonation of him.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Maybe it was just the dark side speaking.
Possible.
Well, I remember didn't the poster have, they used a picture of like a Palpatine figurine or something? I could have sworn it was like artwork taken from something that everyone recognized. Yeah.
Yeah. No, it was. It was, oh, yeah, no, dude, it was from, I think, a sideshow statue or something.
Mm-hmm.
He may have looked more Palpatine-y than Ian McDiermott. You never know.
At this point,
yeah,
maybe.
I remember. I'm like, I remember. Holy shit, I totally forgot about that. That's crazy.
I legit burst out laughing when he said, I've died before. That shit is so funny.
And I'll do it again. You can't stop me.
One more time.
I mean, he's still alive and well in Rey. That's what he said, how it works. So I don't know why we wouldn't.
Yeah, that was
him.
Really confusing to me.
It's confusing to everybody, man. Nobody knew what the fuck was supposed to be happening in that scene.
Yeah, it was like, if you strike me down, I shall live on in you. It's like, well, she did that.
He wins, basically.
So he wins. So he, I mean, he's just going to be like,
no, I win.
So yeah, they wrote that scene. You're like, did you watch the original trilogy? And they're like, huh? Like, you know, he's like, strike me down, and then Luke doesn't, you know.
I'm really looking forward to the year 2030 when we get a Star Wars episode 10, and we discover that there was actually another cloning facility, and Palpatine's there now with like a new body, and that's how like they start the next set of Star Wars trilogies. And they just use AI Ian McDiermott and Darth Maul.
It's sort of become a metaphor for the state of Star Wars, isn't it? Like that production line of Palpatine clones, Star Destroyer, Death Stars, Darth Vader's, just all coming out. And like
ATSTs, yeah, pretty much.
Will between worlds, all the conveyor belts, all the little portals.
I'm recreating a Dark Empire in all like deepfake stuff.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's so cool. Funny, like for a long time, when Lucasfilm initially made that announcement in 2014 about, hey guys, you know, we're basically everything that was expanded universe before, that's going to go into legend status, and now everything we make from now on is going to be canon. It's funny because like some of the excuses that came out around that time were, it's probably the best, look at some of the worst storylines ever in the EU, and always like the top one they used was Dark Empire, and they literally ripped it off and did a worse version of it for Rise of Skywalker. Like the memes make themselves.
I know, it's strange. It's like, let's just make all of this non-existent, but we're gonna pull from it. All right,
what was the Matt Smith stuff gonna be for Rise of Skywalker that got scrapped?
I think allegedly he was supposed to be young Palpatine.
Could have been, or like there was theories about him playing the son, and there was a bunch of shit out there, but I have no idea what was really real. Because all the bullshit rumors that were coming around around that time.
I mean, he could be the son now. Did you hear about the Acolyte rumor leak months ago?
What was it?
About the village and the twin sisters or whatever.
Yes, I know that they're supposed to be twins, like one raised by the Jedi and one that's not.
But do you know the reason she hates them? She hates the Jedi.
Why?
Supposedly there's a village, and then there's like these marauders that come in every once in a while, and they destroy the village, or they take from it. And so the Jedi come to the village because they notice a Force-sensitive child. And so they say, give us this child. And the village says, we'll give you our child only if you protect us from the next raid. Raid comes, they don't show up. Everyone dies, village burns, except for the sister of the Force-sensitive kid that they took. And so they're like, she's like, I fucking hate the Jedi. And then she gets in cahoots with some dark side guy and learns how to use the dark side and like vows to kill them.
Can't wait. Did the trailer come out after we did Last Stargrift? I think it had to have, right? We didn't talk about
it was like just after, I think, like the following day or whatever, right?
On Tuesday came out, yeah.
Yeah. Holy shit, there's a lot of backlash to that thing. I expected there to be backlash. I expected a lot of people not to like it. I didn't expect the overwhelming amount of dislikes. Like it passed 500,000 dislikes a few hours ago.
No way.
Half a million dislikes to 177,000 likes.
No way, dude. Checked.
Yeah.
Are you serious? Holy shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's not just a little. That's not like a split. That is, you know, 70%, 75% of people do not like what they saw. Yeah, and I think it has a lot to do with not just the trailer, but obviously all the conversation surrounding it and everything Leslie Headland and the cast have said. Like, there's a lot of things that go into it, but I am shocked. I knew that I was in all likelihood not going to like what they're giving me with Acolyte, but I'm surprised by the mass backlash towards Lucasfilm over this.
Yeah, people are there's too much in a row of shit. It's like this trailer's not exactly promising. I think the coverage we had on EFAB, I was saying that if this trailer had come out, let's say after Rogue One, I think most people would just been like, I don't know, yeah, I guess we'll give it a shot, see what happens. But it coming out now, like, it's just like, very low expectations.
When I watched it, the likes were, I think it was like 100 or 90,000 likes to like 60 or 70,000 dislikes. And then a week
caught up
500,000. That's crazy.
Yeah.
I want to know what everyone really didn't like about it.
Well, you can go by the comments. You'll get some interesting answers, I suppose.
That's true.
Well, basically all the comments are like, close your eyes. Then some joke.
Yeah. Like, I can't.
the alien. I can't.
There's a new one. There's a new one. Hooper drives the boat. Someone is killing Jedi. It's Disney.
Yeah, it's it's been pretty funny to watch. Yeah, I think there's a couple things to criticize about the actual trailer, besides all the outside stuff. If I hadn't heard anything about this, Star Wars comes out with a new thing, and I watch a trailer, I have no fucking idea, like, even when this is. It could just as easily be set 500 years in the future. Like, there's nothing that I recognize in the trailer that connects it to 100 years before Phantom Menace. Unless you know about the High Republic and have like have recognized the attire and shit like that. But even that, High Republic, nobody fucking paid attention to High Republic. The first book sold like 150,000 copies. Other than that, that's it. Nobody's engaged with High Republic. Nobody knows what's going on. And the sales dropped off significantly after that by 90 or 95%.
Did you read that, by the way?
I read Light of the Jedi, the first one by Kevin Scott, because I kind of wanted to see what it was about. It was pretty dry and boring, but I think they also focus on way too many characters to kind of introduce you in that initial thing. And he didn't get too deep with many of the characters, but I gave it a shot. I didn't really like it very much. But that to me is like the main complaint of the trailer. I don't think it really gives you very much context for what's going on for a normie fan perspective.
Because what I was going to ask was, does the book do that? Does the book give you a good base plate for like what you're getting in that show? Is it connected? Do they care about it like each other as entities? I'm assuming not, because that's typically how Disney do it.
Can you say that again? Sorry.
So basically, does the book have any kind of like prep for you in terms of if you watch that or if you read that, you'd be like, now I know what's going to happen in this show, or I'm prepared. I understand. It's like, I'm assuming they're relatively disconnected.
Light of the Jedi takes place years, but like several years before this. Let me see if I can find out when exactly it was. I want to say it was probably 200 or 150 years before the prequels.
I read maybe a quarter of the book and then I just put it down. I said I was going to get back to it, but I never did.
Yeah, so Light of the Jedi takes place about 130 years before this show. So 230 years BBY.
Yeah. They're introducing that character with the light whip in the movie or in the show.
I guess 100 years before. I did the math wrong. Yeah, 100 years before. But yes, they are Vernesta Rowe or whatever.
Right.
Which, have you seen the light whip depicted in any comic or anything from Vern, whatever her fucking name is?
No, I mean, I've seen it in Legends, like Lumia and whoever else used it.
So the way it's described is wild. From the stuff I've been seeing, which light whips were a thing. We've seen that from Marvel Star Wars comics in like the 80s or something with Lumia and a couple other characters throughout the course of, you know, expanding universe.
Yeah, Dark Horse had tons of them.
The difference is the light whip is like it's made of an actual like material, right? But like a material that like you wrap it up and it's like, you know, 6 feet coiled around, right? It's like hanging on your belt, and then you activate it, and obviously that kind of energy, and it's got different little filaments and stuff that come out.
It's like a spine.
Super dangerous weapon. What it sounds like this character's like she just has a normal lightsaber that turns into a light whip, which makes no fucking sense. And also there's no mass associated with that. It doesn't even fucking make sense how you would whip it.
So there's like it's just a hilt and then it turns into a noodle?
Yes, like it goes from like a normal ass fucking lightsaber, and then now she flips a switch and, you know,
and it goes limp.
We must have seen that before in something. I got something in my head. Chat, help me out. What have we seen where it's like a whip style thing that turns into an actual stick type sword weapon? That's got to be in some sci-fi. I can see it in my head, but I was like, it's not Star Wars, I don't think.
Yeah. I mean, are you thinking of Wonder Woman?
No, I don't think it's Wonder Woman. I'm going to keep an eye on suggestions. I'm almost certain I've seen it from something. No, I'm not talking about parodies. Like Family Guy.
Spaceballs, yeah.
Spaceballs. I mean, like an actual... It's supposed to be, like, cool. Like, you have a big flippy flappy thing, and then you can press a button, it'll, like, go erect.
Are you talking about Batman? Like, Christian Bale's Batman?
No, but Bloodborne is actually close, kind of, to what I'm thinking about, but not... I'm thinking of something that glowed. I can't remember what sci-fi thing it was.
Soul Calibur Ivy?
Iron Man 2? No, because that's mainly whips, right? I don't think he makes them into, like, swords or anything. Pacific Rim. Ooh, was it Pacific Rim? That could be it.
Oh, maybe.
Yeah. I don't have any problem with them introducing a light whip or anything like that. The problem is if you do it in this way, that makes no sense with how lightsabers work.
Yeah.
Instead of again, if you're gonna fucking take shit, you know, that's been done before, do it right. That's kind of always my issue, because then we decide to nod or make little changes. Hey, it's cool that they use it like a whip. Let's just make this lightsaber be a whip now. Mm-hmm. It really undermines everything.
I know exactly what you mean. It's like, if you're gonna steal it, can you please steal the good idea, not steal half of it?
Yes.
The Halo show is filled with that. They'll like a third of the way steal a thing, and so it's just completely fucked. That's finished now, by the way.
I had not seen a single moment from season 2 that wasn't just like a little clip or something on Twitter.
People are arguing over whether or not it was worse than the first season, which was dog shit. That's where it's at. It's like, was it dog shit? It's like, maybe. Might be better than that, but also might be worse than this. Like, I don't know. Whether or not it gets a season 3 is up in the air, but like, it doesn't deserve one. I know that. I'm not like as into Halo as a lot of people are, but friends of mine are. I'm watching them cry like when watching the show. You can't help but feel it's like, ugh.
Pacific Rim has a wild, like, segmented sword.
I think that's what I was thinking of.
That's with John Boyega, right?
He's in the second one, yeah.
Ah. No, I haven't seen it.
Most people, I think, thought the second one was shit. First one was the one people liked.
Over the weekend was Immaculate.
Hmm. What do you think?
Shit.
Ah. Well,
just because Sydney Sweeney was in it?
No, my friend wanted to go see it. So I was like, all right.
I mean, fair enough.
And then, of course, I mean, Sydney Sweeney's.
I haven't heard great things about it. Doesn't look like it's doing super well at the box office.
No,
it
was.
I haven't seen
it. I
saw Ghostbusters.
How was that?
I don't like it. I wasn't a big fan of Afterlife. Like, I thought it was okay, and I thought it was coming from a place of good intentions. Like, I feel like they were trying to honor the things that came before, but I didn't like a lot of the new characters, and overall, it was just very meh for me. This one, I wish it would have just stopped. I think they just need to stop making Ghostbusters movies.
Everything.
I know. There were way too many. Ironically, this week's episode of Bad Batch, I didn't mind. I didn't despise it as much as I expected to. But there's a line in there from Crosshair where he's like, "I'm not going to like this, am I?" And Omega's like, "You don't like anything." And he's like, "You're right, I don't." I thought that was pretty funny. But no, there were too many characters and there wasn't enough time spent on the ones that they already had. Kamel Nanjiani, whatever his fucking name is, the dude from Eternals. I hated his character. I don't know. I did not like Frozen Empire, and it's probably going to end up capping around 200 million, 225 million at the box office, and probably going to lose money for him.
So that is a non-recommendation then, huh?
I don't recommend
it. I haven't even seen Afterlife, and I am a huge fan of Ghostbusters, the original, but I've always assumed that I ain't getting that ever again. Like, that's just not happening.
I feel like the first Ghostbusters is truly one of those lightning in a bottle type of movies where you could try to recreate it a million times and it never quite hits right. I'm just over it. There's some big Ghostbusters fans who really liked it. I'm not a massive Ghostbusters fan. I would not recommend it. So, I don't know.
Yeah. I feel like they're taking a lot of old classic movies and making sequels now. Beetlejuice. There's a new Karate Kid coming out. What else are they doing? They're just doing something else.
Well, Karate Kid's definitely like, off the success of Cobra Kai, and they're like, we got to capitalize on this.
But this one's different. I don't understand. It's Ralph Macchio and Jackie Chan.
Mm-hmm.
And it takes place after Cobra Kai. I don't know. I guess it could be interesting. I just have no idea what it's about, really.
But the era of like trying to, remake everything, that we're going back what? Like, where would you even pick? Because you could go back as far as 20. There's like an era switch where we went from them being kind of like, like Terminator 3 to Terminator Genesis.
Yeah.
Whatever. Draw a line between those two. That's the era change.
Shit.
Well, when they were, Terminator 3 was shit. Like everyone thought it was shit because it was being compared to Terminator 2. But in retrospect, like people are like, well, Terminator 3 is pretty awesome compared to Genesis and Dark Fate. And it's like, yeah.
Probably like this rewatch it.
New era of bad. They used to, the sequels used to be, we want to try and recreate the one that everyone loved. And they usually do it badly, right? Like a sequelitis. Yeah. These days, they'll try and go for like, well, what if we did this but deconstructed it? What if we did this but subverted this? What if we did this but it was a team of women instead of a team of men? Which
I hate when they do that. And we don't know that.
Is the Pirates of the Caribbean one even happening anymore? The women pirates?
It's still supposedly in production. They're still moving forward with it, yeah. All female, female-focused Pirates of the Caribbean reboot.
It was, I was talking to my dad about this, and he had no idea what it was. I was like, so do you want to watch Ocean's 11 but women, Ghostbusters but women, or Pirates of the Caribbean but women? And he was like, why? And I was just like, you gotta pick one.
Women and men in it, and it'd be good?
Yeah. Well, what was crazy is, like, there are female characters in all of those movies. The original versions that like people really enjoy,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. But there's not enough of them.
I suppose what's funny though is you get the Ghostbusters 2016. Most people said Chris Hemsworth's character was like the only one they liked because he was like a dopey idiot who's trying his best, sort of thing. So he had like some level of endearment to him. And then you think about Barbie, Ken being like the most popular. It's like, What is happening? Yeah, fucking John Walker being like a surprise hero in Falcon the Winter Soldier, when they're like, no, you're supposed to dislike him. You're like, oh.
Do better, Senator.
Do better.
Wrote the new Fallout show. You know, I've never played Fallout. I mean, I played it for an hour at my buddy's house once in like 2012 or something. That was it.
Which game do you know?
Oh, geez. There was a number to it. Fallout 64, 54.
Fallout 76.
Fallout 64.
Yeah.
I'd play that.
I didn't know what I was doing. I was just running around kind of like a barren wasteland. Figuring.
It is how it goes. Yeah. They've shared some clips online, like with this, that, and the other part of the show, parts of trailers, and then things on their own. Seen people already pretty mad. I don't know that we should be expecting anything other than probably crap, but I'm more than willing to give it a shot. It might work out. You never know, right?
There's some things that look like, in terms of the world and everything, there's certain things that I thought looked good, and it looks like it's probably pretty fucking expensive. Yeah. But then when it comes to any of the character interactions, other than the ghoul, I don't find anybody that they showed us in those trailers interesting at all, especially not the main character, which could be a problem.
Is there anything you guys are excited for right now? Like, actually, it looks promising.
House of the Dragon season two. All right. Let's fucking go, baby. All right. Listen, this might surprise your audience theory, but I'm actually Team Black. All right.
Oh, that's interesting coming from a racist. So
I know, right? What about you, Mahler?
See, I just think that he's saying that until he can get in their good graces and then stab them all in the back. That's what he's going to do. He's going to be like, yeah, I'm with you guys. Yeah. And
then... Yeah, I'm known for pandering to Black people. That's me. But yeah, it's Blacks versus Greens. So if you don't know, it's the origin of the Blacks versus the Greens is based off like dress colors for these two women. But anyway, you have the Greens, so Aegon and Alicent and Otto and the people who are in power at King's Landing. Then you have Queen Rhaenyra and the Blacks, who are all the people who are kind of trying to usurp and take back her throne. And the marketing, I loved how they're like leaning into it with the marketing.
Yeah, that's
and
cool.
Really telling everybody that, hey, we set up all the pieces in the first season. Now it's time to fucking choose a side because we're going to war.
Yeah.
Yeah, for me, I'm quite fond of, I think my three favorite characters are Otto, Aemond, and Daemon. So I'm a little bit split but I don't know what's going to happen for everybody. So right now I'm like happy to just see how it rolls out. But in terms of like who's more evil maybe, and that I could pick it that way, it's like, stacking up some ill deeds on both sides. It's hard to say who the most evil is, but I imagine after a few episodes, it's going to keep going back and forth. Like,
wait till you see episode one.
Yeah, I figure. So, yeah, I don't know if I was to rewatch season one right now, I might be able to give you an answer. But I kind of, I'm just really up for watching it happen. You know,
Even the way Ryan says black, racist.
Mm-hmm.
I pronounce my words black.
Yeah, Shogun as well, that's coming out and it's top notch. We had Gentleman just drop out. We would be saying it would be exciting to follow it if they released it properly, which would be one per week, but they fucked that up. Seriously, like the Gentleman, it's so hard to build up word of mouth when it's out already. All of it's done. It's like it's come and gone almost. If that was weekly, it would have been way better.
Yeah, the weekly release of, again, If you don't have a good show, it's not going to matter, right? If you don't have a good show, if you release it weekly, that's not going to make it a successful show. But if you have a good show, I feel like if it's out for 8 weeks and people talk about it the first 2 weeks and like, holy shit, that's actually pretty fucking good. And you get more people on board, and you're all experiencing it together. By the time that final episode comes out, like you can really grow your audience. And I think that we saw that with House of the Dragon.
Absolutely.
You
know,
I was skeptical of shit. That, dude. You definitely do.
You know, like levels of hype, if you get to plus 100 and then all the way down to negative 100, I was at like negative, probably like 80, 70 for House of the Dragon. By the time the last episode came out, I was happily at 80 at least. I was all the way on the other side. And I remember like the first thing everyone's talking about is, do you remember that shot with Vhagar being above the dragon in the shadows and stuff? It's like, fucking hell. If that season had dropped day one all at once, I might have watched it, but like we wouldn't have had all those conversations, all those promotions of the show. Yeah. All those streams, all those discussions, breakdowns, predictions. And it's just like, yeah, you miss out on all of it. And I don't know why they've not. Because do you know that Arcane Season 1, it came out in threes. Why else would they do that other than recognizing the benefit of allowing it to stir?
They are, like, you know. Netflix has been bending on that the past couple of years. Remember Stranger Things, which I still haven't watched, by the way, but Stranger Things Season 4.
Yeah.
I've never seen a single episode of Stranger Things.
I mean, it's kind of worth seeing Season 1 and 4.
It's enjoyable.
Mostly 1.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of people recommend it, so I'll get around to it maybe when it's all out, by the time Millie Bobby Brown's 35 years old and finally season 5 out. But that they split into two parts. Yeah. The Witcher, they started doing parts. Like, they understand that they are, even though they're still the top dog by far, that they do need to adapt a little bit when it comes to that release model.
I genuinely, it's only been bad for the gentleman because it's actually hard to keep mentioning it because it's just like the thing that's it's just long gone already, it feels like. And then you like build hype for the next season, which won't be for ages. You know, Arcane Season 2 will be the end of this year, so that'll have its cycle, especially if they do 333. That'll work out pretty well. What else is
Arcane?
There?
Arcane is the
CGI, the right? League of Legends animated show.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So my my team was like, yeah, the Vader fan film is gonna look somewhat like that. I was like, cool. And that's the only time I heard about Arcane.
I adore the animation in that show, so that'll be cool.
Well, we were thinking of doing it like
that. Oh, thinking going that direction, we went a different one.
Yeah, and then we went into the more realistic Old Republic. But I really liked that style. But it's also very, very expensive.
Oh yeah.
Let me bring this up. And yeah, someone said that this is a clickbait title. No, this is actually this is our last episode until shows are done, and then we'll. But that being said, I have one final proposition for you guys that I won't say publicly. We can talk about it after. You'll probably say no, but
one final proposition.
One final proposition.
Hmm.
It's the last of my cards. Last of my cards.
Last of your cards.
Do you happen to rewatch the prequels by any chance, either of you?
No, I haven't had any free moments. I don't need to, though. Did you?
Yeah.
I did too.
Did you?
Yeah. I did not get all the way through the Obi-Wan Anakin fight, but yeah.
That's fine. Really? That's the one that you like, tapped out on?
I ran out of time. I was watching it today.
Could be watching it literally on mute right now to finish up and look at you.
Then I wouldn't get it though. Like the one thing that I was gonna say specifically about Revenge of the Sith was when it comes to like the soundtrack and the moodiness and the broodiness of it, and the little moments of darkness that come out like throughout the entire score. That might be like my favorite fucking soundtrack, might be Revenge of the Sith.
Of all time?
Of Star Wars, it probably of all time.
I usually end up saying Revenge of the Sith is the best of the six. I'm not even including the sequels because I'm not insane. The best soundtrack out of the six.
You mean the whole movie? Or like one in particular?
No, I love the entire thing. I think it's fantastic. What's cool about it is how many different songs there are, different styles that they approach. Obviously, everything to do with like, well, everything. There's no point in specifying necessarily unless you want to.
You know what I always found really cool about that, about the Revenge of the Sith, is that every scene with Anakin, almost every scene, one half of his face is covered in shadows.
Mm-hmm.
Every scene that's shot.
Pretty much. I also noticed that it feels like there was a big focus on lighting like that for Revenge of the Sith.
Yeah.
Which isn't necessarily the same way in Attack of the Clones. But that's definitely something I noticed, was there was a focus on. And when you're doing these all fucking digital sets like they are, like that is a very conscious lighting decision for them to make. And I don't know exactly if it was a struggle for filming at all like that, but it definitely get the message across they're trying to send with it.
Tell you what was a struggle for filming, C-3PO. That reflective son of a gun was the most difficult thing to film for George.
Because you can see like the camera in him, or
because you can see the green screen, you can see the blue screen, you can see the camera, you can see everything. It's like, imagine taking out the blue screen, but it's like part of 3PO because he's reflective.
Well, that'd be annoying.
Yeah. It'd be very difficult. That's why droids that are not shiny are much easier. Even lightsaber hilts, like Anakin's lightsaber hilt. So we were shooting for the for my site. Very, very, very shiny hilt. And it was like impossible because it's just so difficult to not get the reflections of everything.
Well, what did you, Mahler, since you recently rewatched them, was there anything you got from it? Phantom Menace, Attack of the Clones, anything that you maybe didn't notice before, something you appreciated it about
I
it?
I tell you what, every time I rewatch them, my rankings change for Phantom Menace and Attack of the Clones. This time around, I thought Phantom Menace was better. When I oftentimes sell with Attack of the Clones, and I think it's because of the fact that it's fucking Clone Wars. It's like, yeah, but Phantom Menace, it's hard for me not to love that one because of Darth Maul anyway, but... You know, I was watching and I think I was more happy this time around with Qui-Gon than I ever have been. I think I always did enjoy him, right? And then I had a lot of discussions over the internet of people saying, like, he's stoic as an excuse for his, like, lack of characterization and acting, which is, like, a thing that spread primarily probably from Red Letter Media. But at the same time, you watch it and it's like, oh, man, all I can think of is I would have liked a lot more of him. It's just one of the most interesting characters in the Star Wars universe and seeing how he acts
easily.
Where he decides to use the Force, you know, stuff like that.
He gives a great performance.
Like I really enjoy him.
I think Liam Neeson's really fucking good in it, especially surrounded by, obviously he had to carry a lot of it when he's surrounded by a young Natalie Portman, a young Jake Lloyd, fucking Jar Jar Binks. Like a lot of it is focused on him.
Well, he and Jar Jar are carrying it, is what you mean.
Obviously, that's what I mean. That's right.
Yeah.
Anything you were thinking of this time around?
For me, I always go to the final battle scene in Phantom Menace. And although it is obviously offset by some of the goofiness of the Gungan versus battle droid battle, I really liked the pacing all throughout that final, you know, 20-minute battle scene where you're going boom, da, boom, da, boom, da, boom, da, boom, and all of the low points hit at the same time, and then you get the high points if it's actually high, not exactly high when Qui-Gon's dying in Obi-Wan's arms, but I really appreciate that final battle sequence, and it brings me right back to when I was a kid watching that shit and how it blew me away.
There's little things that I think a lot of people look over, and that is, like, for example, just how resolute Qui-Gon is fighting Maul. There's just no fear at all. He's like, yeah, I got this, I'm gonna go after you, even though he's a fucking tough guy to beat.
Yeah, and he's old. Qui-Gon's old as shit, like 50 something or even 60.
He's definitely past his prime at that point, to the point where, because I think Qui-Gon supposed to be an Ataru specialist, which obviously, it kind of, when you get to that age, you're not going to be able to do some of the same. Well, unless you're fucking Yoda, he can still flip around, do whatever the fuck he wants. But for most, for humans, you know, you're not going to be able to do to fight in kind of the same manner that you've always fought your entire life. But yeah, it's a perfect description of what, you know, Qui-Gon's calm, centered, trusting in the Force. And Darth Maul is just sitting there prowling like a fucking animal.
He's just unleashing all of that angst from those years of being pent up. Well,
I assume you guys would feel that Obi-Wan maybe came close to getting a bit of dark side in him in that fight at the end.
100%. I think he came close, but I think he was just more focused. But I think he came pretty damn close. That was probably the closest he's ever come.
He 100%, you know, tapped into his emotions. You can see it in his eyes. You can see it in the way that he fights. To me, still, when he rushes in there and, like, wraps around, and that first back and forth they have when Maul goes ch-ch-ch, and Obi-Wan's doing the block, boom, like, boom, boom. That's boom. One of my favorite sequences.
I was about to say, that might be my favorite individual piece of choreography in all of Star Wars.
Yeah, it's so badass, dude.
Yeah. I used to do that when I was fucking... I was at my job when I was, like, early in high school, and, like, when I had to fucking sweep or mop or whatever, you end up with a fucking broom handle and be fucking pretend I was fucking fighting. Pretend I was Obi-Wan Kenobi with a mop handle. But then obviously we see that for all the gains he makes, he fucking loses. Yeah, here it is.
Yeah.
you about to get John Williams about to fuck your asshole.
I was gonna say, be careful.
That bounce. He's ready. Boom. Yeah. Ooh.
Yeah, dude, there's a little bit of darkness in there, for sure.
Yeah. What?
Because he was not fighting like that 20 minutes ago.
No. And, well, and I was going to say, obviously, we're about to see him fucking get his ass beat here.
Yeah, he still loses.
Yeah, exactly. He's tapped into all of this, and he ends up fucking losing.
Yeah, it's because he was not too focused on his anger right there, right?
Exactly.
Right there, he's like, yeah, I'm going to kill you. Oh, shit. And Maul's like, bro, I am the darkness. This is nothing new for me.
Literally, he fucking... It's exactly what happened to fucking Qui-Gon in terms of, like, that move. And, he could have just fucking ran him through right there. You know what I mean? Like, he could have done that to Obi-Wan right there. But instead, he force pushes. Yeah. Go to right when Obi-Wan gets back. Imagine if Maul follows up with one hit to the head. With one fucking pommel to the head.
What do you mean? Force pushes him and then...
No. So, like, when he
right here,
pushes him back off the lock, if he follows up with a pommel strike to the face, he's basically stunned and he could have ran him.
It is an opening, yeah, I assume. But the force push is faster, I guess, than the stabbing.
So essentially, kind of like what Obi-Wan did right here. Boom, he could have just done that to him. Why didn't he just step over him? Why didn't he just step over him and stab him right there?
Because he wanted to do a sick flip.
he tried, I guess.
Yeah. Do you guys buy the whole this experience with Maul, how he beats him, is what gives him like prep and expectations on the shit with Anakin and him in their sort of their end of their duel?
What's this?
So like the idea that him coming over Darth Maul and then slicing him gives him a sense of like knowing what to expect when Anakin comes over him.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, so I assume that was deliberate.
Yeah, it was in the comic. Well, I don't know about deliberate for George, but it was deliberate for in the comics once Disney came in. I remember seeing something where Anakin was training with a droid that he made look like Darth Maul. And then Obi-Wan and Mace Windu and Palpatine were all watching him from the balcony above. And Obi-Wan's like, he's been obsessed with hearing about my stories of the Zabrak. And Anakin just like kept training with this droid and trying to beat him. So that he could basically... He's been going toe-to-toe with Obi-Wan since he was a kid. Just kind of, like, prove that he's better.
Dude, I wish...
I'll see you in 10 years!
The expression Maul has when he's been defeated is such a, like, what? Fuck. Damn. And I just, like...
He's like, are you serious? Like, what?
Yeah.
I forgot about that lightsaber.
You... Bitch. Yeah, it's one of the sickest fights, dude. Seriously is.
If only Obi-Wan, or if only Darth Maul had been Reva, he would have survived.
Yeah.
Or sorry, if only Qui-Gon had been Reva, he would have survived.
Oh, that too. Like, they would have been in the movie still, yeah.
Yeah, it's quite unfortunate.
And this is in Rebels, Mahler.
I've seen this.
The lightsaber's very skinny now, old man.
There's a Qui-Gon there. That
goodbye, William. My lover. Goodbye,
what are generally
my
friend. The takes on that from like fans, because I liked it from what I saw, but I don't know if there's like criticism or praise of it that I haven't heard.
It's criticism on everything.
Yeah, but still, I find it interesting, right? Like, what do you guys think of it?
I think most Rebels fans really like it. I get the messaging behind it. Yeah. I just...
too slow. Too quick. But I guess that's the point.
Well, that's what they're going for, right?
100%. Yeah. That's 100% the point. As somebody who thinks that this should have been the end of Darth Maul, I don't really feel like it's like, oh, what a great conclusion to Maul and Obi-Wan's. No, fuck that. It was over right there. Like, to me, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Oh, I get that, yeah.
I think most Rebels fans really enjoy that. In terms of who presented it to the general Star Wars audience, I have no idea. They'd probably be as confused as they were when he popped up at the end of Solo.
Well, so how does it work with continuity? It's like, that's a flash forward, I guess, in Rebels?
That is taking place in Rebel. That timeline of Rebels probably a couple years before A New Hope.
Yeah. Okay.
Right? I think that final season of Rebels takes place just a few years before A New Hope.
I thought it was like right before.
Yeah, yeah. There's not that much time. When does final...
Because you hear Aunt Beru say the same thing she does in episode 4, but I mean, she's like, Luke, good calling out for him, but...
It's 1 year before A New Hope. Yeah. 1 year before.
Mola basing his opinions off others. I just want to know what they think.
Wow, how dare you base your opinions off others?
Especially because I've got such little context, right? You guys would have thought about it for much longer than I have.
Yeah, so Sam came on. We did Rule of Two with Mark, and he came to Collider, and he explained how that scene was done. And it was like Maul, Obi-Wan was essentially taking different forms of his life in that moment. So he was like, you know, I'm Kenobi, the Clone Wars. No, wait, I'm not. I'm a Jedi or something like this. And he puts it forwards. And then he's like, no, wait, I'm Qui-Gon. And then he goes like in the Qui-Gon stance. So he takes different forms for it. And it was pretty poetic.
Yeah, I like stuff like that. Yeah, that's not allowed to have friends. Yeah. You know, one of the other ones I like is the interpretation of like the metaphor in Yoda and Palpatine's battle of him throwing literal like star systems at him, as in controlling the galaxy, not like in the actual literal sense, but more so in the way that he controls
like a senator
the
who represents a system or whatever, and it's
yeah, like his
at him. Yeah,
corruption is complete to the point of he can just manipulate whole systems to his advantage against Yoda. Like, that's kind of cool. And Yoda spinning one and throwing it back—that was obviously Alderaan. Nobody cares about that. It's gonna explode anyway.
I never heard of that.
No, I still think Attack of the Clones is the most memeable of all the movies. Like, probably. Even little things like when Obi-Wan goes in to talk to Dex and like, sit down, blah, 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 blah. And like, he literally sits down for half a second before he's even comfortable and like bounces back up. It's just like little silly things in that movie.
I thought Revenge of the Sith was the most memeable and most tragic at the same time, because there's so many memes in Revenge of the Sith.
There are a lot.
Do it.
Like the prequels in general.
Yeah, yeah.
Only money. Are you an angel? Now this is pod racing. I'll try spinning. That's a good trick.
That's a good trick.
Yeah, we'll see. There's a couple just like random. There's a couple like random exclamations from Anakin and Phantom Menace that randomly bother me this
yippee
time around. Yeah. Yeah, yippee. Or like even when he's like getting the pod racer ready and Qui-Gon fucking picks him up and like puts him in there, he just goes like, whoa! It's like, what are you freaking out about?
Did he?
Yeah, he goes, whoa! It's like Qui-Gon puts him in there. It's like, you're literally about to go like a fucking million miles an hour. You know what I mean? Like, all the, like, the G-force that's on your body, the all that shit, but like, that's what, that gets a whoa out of you. I don't
well,
know.
It's probably because it's, like, it's the first so time funny. He has like a father figure do it, you know?
It's the first time a man's touched me. Thanks, Qui-Gon.
Whoa.
All right.
Maybe I think Phantom Menace could really have done with more Darth Maul scenes, okay? We didn't have enough. We need a few more hours, I would say. Just pop them in.
Well, so Nick Dillard actually shot... was it half an hour or 4 hours? I think it was 4 hours of the fight. that never was put in. Like, there was a shit ton more footage. There was some crazy.
I wasn't even just talking about the fight. I mean, like, we get like one scene that's pretty quick for Darth Maul's character. Would have loved a bit more, you know? Because he's like, we're going to take revenge after all these years. And you're like, oh, yeah, fair enough. I get you. But, you know, hearing him, I don't know exactly what context I would use, but I would definitely want to, you know, if only we reduced maybe some Jar Jar time. I know that sounds a bit crazy, but I'm just saying. Possibility.
What? Really? You cut Jar Jar? Go ahead.
Had the most negative impact on the galaxy, the elitist clone-minded ways of the Jedi or the tyrannical nature of the Sith? Probably the Jedi, to be honest.
I'd say probably the Sith, because...
Probably the Sith, right?
Yeah, because it's like peace and prosperity, like all these things, and the only... At that point, like, the negative machinations in the galaxy are literally being driven by the Sith themselves. Like, they're the ones that are behind all this conflict and shit. So I would probably say Sith, not to say the Jedi are perfect or anything.
I just, the older I grow, the more I find the Jedi are just so brainwashed by politics. I'm just like, these guys are...
They're definitely lame and gay. They don't even let you fuck. I mean, that sucks, obviously.
Well, yeah, and they insert themselves everywhere, right? They think pawns. That they know best. Yeah. I get that. But that's I feel like that's still better than the Sith.
Yeah.
I mean, they're both shitty.
I mean, I would definitely be a Sith. But just saying,
I would be a Sith
for myself, not for the betterment of the galaxy.
Mm-hmm.
I would be a Sith. Yeah, I'd be a in between. I just got force powers and I'm strong as hell. But that's it. Sad to see the show go. Also, do you guys? All right, what's up, Mr. Penguin? You guys need to do the podcast when the Phantom Menace 25th anniversary re-release comes out in theaters. Oh, on May 4th?
Yeah, so that we could do a reaction to the special footage of the Acolyte that they're going to show at all Phantom Menace show-ins.
Oh, right, yeah.
Just to remind you, it's a prequel to the prequels.
Right, just to remind you, it's connected. Yeah, for sure. Sad to see this show end. Loved all the different views on Star Wars content.
That was really funny to theory. Grey Jedi Serena.
Cheers to the final episode of Stargrift. Ryan Mahler, I love you guys' dynamic, and are the two who have the best zingers on FNT that always get overlooked. Love all three of you guys. Can't wait for your Acolyte review.
We do try and help each other out sometimes when we're the only ones that notice each other's jokes and everyone else is laughing. It's like, ah, that one's going to waste. You missed it.
That's true. Chad's going on a rant about AI or some shit.
Yeah, and it's like, he just said bat cheese. And nobody's noticed. Nobody cares.
To bat cheese?
Yeah, it fucking killed me.
My kids are really into Batman right now, and he comes up and asks for everything bat, you know, a bat phone. He asks for bat cheese, and I give it to him. It's like, bat cheese?
Everyone didn't care, except I was just losing it. Like, come up asking for bat cheese.
It is so outrageous.
Can we expect a Stargrift episode to come back for the Acolyte?
Yeah.
Yeah, at the end.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if something is super controversial, I think we could probably get the boys together if we all...
With a little bit of notice, right? Like, if say, for example, Star Wars gets sold to fucking Apple, he'd be like, yeah, we could do an episode.
So Acolyte looks like garbage, huh?
A little bit.
I was pumped to see the Phantom Menace 25th anniversary return to theaters until I found out they were sticking the Acolyte trailer in front of it. I guess I could skip all the previews and then take my seat. I think it comes at the end.
From what I heard, I think it comes at the end, but I've just heard people talk about it. I'd never actually saw like a press release or an article or anything. But yeah.
First ever super chat, long overdue. Thanks, Andrew. Love you all, but specifically, I have been following Mahler since his The Last Jedi Rage video years ago, and he has since been my go-to listen with the EFAP crew. Appreciate all of you guys. Much love.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
In honor of the last regular Stargrift and our fallen trooper Nemec Ryan, can you please read Nemec's manifesto in Omega's voice, please, and thank you. I don't know what that is.
Well, is Ryan willing? I wouldn't blame him if he wouldn't want to.
I mean,
I'm like, our Fallen Trooper Nemec. Nemec's Manifesto. I don't know if I'm familiar with that.
It's Andor, right?
Yeah, but like, you want me to read the entire fucking thing?
It's quite long.
Yeah, it's just, like, I don't know it from memory.
Sentences. Just do a few sentences.
All right. Let's see. Let me search Nemec's Manifesto. You can keep reading.
Speaking of Raid, I'm watching federal agents raid P. Diddy's house live right now on the news.
Hmm.
Oh, really? Your favorite French guy here. What's up, Pierre Gossin? One last time for the grifters. Those Mondays were awesome. Cheers to the three of you, and we'll follow your careers with great interest. May the force be with you all. Love.
Well, thank you.
Thank you, Pierre. Anyone of y'all interested in getting the Jabba the Hutt popcorn bucket?
Usually pick up a few of them, right? One to use, one to keep.
There is a Jabba the Hutt popcorn bucket they're releasing at like Disneyland or no, maybe they're giving them away at the Phantom Menace things. I don't fucking know.
But this is real?
Yeah, it's like his head fucking pops open. So you can use it.
Interesting. The Jedi Vernestra Ro has a purple lightsaber that can turn into a whip, a light whip in the Acolyte. Via Culture Crave 4 days ago.
Mm-hmm. We talked about it a little bit.
Mm.
What are each of your top three duels in Star Wars? I mean, well, hey, easy. Episode 1, Phantom Menace with Qui-Gon, Obi-Wan, and Maul, and then probably Yoda and Dooku, and then Anakin, Obi-Wan.
Yeah, for me, I'd put Anakin, Obi-Wan first. Like, that's my favorite one, I think, just because of like the emotions behind it and everything. My second favorite would probably be Duel of the Fates. And I like Yoda Dooku, but I like the whole sequence. I like seeing Dooku thrash Obi-Wan and handle Anakin and then see Yoda come in. So yeah. I guess I have the same top three, just a different order.
This is a little tough because the 2 meters I go by are the choreography and then the emotional weight, and it can like really change my answers. But
Luke Skywalker and Vader is like, yeah.
The throne room fight is not even like mind blowing choreography wise, but it's just everything that's happening for those characters in that room makes me so invested in that fight every time I watch it. And then I absolutely adore the Bespin fight. All kinds of the choreography and the how much of Vader is like a hunter in that scene and has pretty much full control until he realizes he better be careful, you know, like when Luke gets the hit on him and then he takes his hand off. I always love that as a dynamic because the movie uses, right, is one that he uses earlier, gives him an opening to take Luke's hand if he wanted, but he doesn't at that point. He's like, I'm playing with you, I've got you. But then later on, he's like, okay, you're losing your fucking hand, you just hit me. Enough of this shit. Like, I love that aspect. But I'd be lying if I said, you know, Duel of Fates, Anakin and Obi-Wan, and Dooku versus Anakin and Obi-Wan. I really like all of those fights as well. So it's really hard to rank them. But I think my number one and number two would both be Luke and Vader. And then three is like a tie between a lot of the prequel ones. There would be no sequel battles present in this fucking ranking ever.
Mauler has a bigger bazooka than Josh.
Hmm.
Star Wars The Last Grift. It's been good times, boys. Glad you're keeping yourself from overextending. Long man, best of luck to all three of you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Aki Faki.
So the traitors leave. Want to have a German wingman? We inspired the Empire. Pretty cool.
That's not very funny.
Yeah. Just finished Heir to the Empire Trilogy. Wow. Love the series. Any book recommendations to continue the story of Luke, Han, Leia, and her two new kids, Jason and Jaina? Thanks for getting me hooked into EU. Gonna miss this trio. Yeah, me too.
Awesome. That's cool, Michael. What I would read after that would maybe be I'd get in the Jedi Academy trilogy, maybe. If you really like the kids and want to see like their like how they end up getting trained, the Young Jedi Knights series, that's fucking awesome as well. I'd read that after Jedi Academy. That has a lot of Jason and Jaina. Obviously, it's geared towards a younger audience, but
Jason and Jaina Solo.
The Acolyte writer's room is solid with writers from House of Dragon, HBO, Watchmen, Mr. Robot, and more. Why did Ryan make a vid saying it's going to be bad?
Have you listened to anyone talk about the Acolyte and how, first and foremost, it's all about diversity and identity politics? One of those writers has never seen Star Wars, yet Leslie Headland was bragging about hiring that person.
Yeah.
So all I have to do is open my ears and listen to what these people are telling me. They're not even hiding what they're going to do. Every single one of the cast has come out. They haven't talked about fucking how much they love Star Wars. All they've talked about is how happy we bring diversity to fucking Star Wars. Jodie Turner Smith. Finally, we get a woman in Star Wars. Yes, we've had too many men in Star Wars. It's a very patriarchal story. That's how she spoke at Star Wars fucking celebration. And there's a reason all those goddamn morons that went up there to talk about their fucking show. There's a reason that every single one of their interviews got ratioed. It's because people are seeing right through this bullshit and they don't fucking want it. That's why that trailer's ratioed. So apparently I'm not the only one that thinks it's going to be fucking horse shit.
Well, there's an answer.
Yeah. Hey, Mahler, last week you brought up Soma and its themes on what it means to be human. Might I suggest the Talos Principle, a physics-based puzzle game with similar themes on humanity and philosophy.
I've had that suggested to me a couple times, thanks to my Soma interest. I have it, and I should get around to it at some point. Just got a whole list of shows, movies, and games to get to someday. But thank you for the recommendation.
Thanks, Sean. I want to see Geode fight. Oh, that'd be wild. Geode fights the thing. Michael Batty with Half says, love you lads and your delightfully diverse dynamic. Some name changes for your consideration. Stargrift monthly, Bombard Grift bi-monthly. That would be great. Pharaoh grace us with his return one last time. I don't know. Sad this is ending. I like all three of you. I do have a question for Mahler. Did you have to take down your Loki season one EFAP reactions?
No, they never existed. We did season one coverage in the form of like an episode. The season two ones were the only time we did like direct reactions and stuff. People asked the same thing about Mandalorian. We never did season one, but we did season two and three. I don't think anything currently that's been released for EFAP has been taken down, or at least on my end or YouTube's end right now. I think everything's still up. So anything you find, or rather can't find, doesn't exist. At least I think so, anyway.
Stargriff special, regardless. I'm excited to imbibe whatever content you boys invent going forwards, especially the Acolyte review.
Sweet.
All good things can come to an end. Started watching the Clone Wars after being frustrated with live-action Ahsoka. I'm understanding why even fans don't care for Season 1. Of course, yeah, you can understand easily.
You got to start with the movie, though. If you didn't start with the movie, that's a big mistake.
If people think the Acolyte ratio is bad, think about what the Rey movie is going to be. Ooh. Acolyte current ratio likes 177 to 520.
Yep.
Yeah, that Rey movie, I anticipate 750,000 dislikes.
Well, this one's not done yet. Let's not undersell this one. This one's got a long way to go.
Yeah, do you mean like in the first week for the Rey movie trailer, or
that's in first day? Week. Yeah, 500 to 750,000. Because it's ultimately what destroyed the sequels. You know, now they're trying to continue that story, and it's like, has nothing to do with Rey. It's just you're taking something that destroyed six films before it, and you're now trying to stretch it and continue it. It's like, what do you expect is going to be the feedback?
Yeah, and it also has the added, again, the same thing Acolyte has, is the added narrative about the person who's in charge of this, Charmaine Obaid-Chinoy, and certain things she said. So that's going to get a lot of attention.
Yeah, they're almost. I think this came up on an open bar, but they're almost in a worse position than if they would be with a blank IP. Like, if the Acolyte were a new IP, it would have a hell of a lot less dislikes.
Yes, because I don't think that the trailer was, like, horrifically bad or anything. I think the trailer was a little uninspired and lacked a lot of specifics. It's everything surrounding, everything they've told us about this series that is really making people skeptical.
Bring back Rule of Three. Whatever happened to that? Rule of Three. Oh, with the boys? Yeah, I'd have to ask them if they're available. I asked them to have a separate show, but they were quite busy. Mahler, just came across the EFAP highlight of the most embarrassing The Rise of Skywalker trailer reaction. It is probably the funniest thing I will see all year.
Yeah, the highlights channel is moving through like all the classic stuff. Make sure to leave a comment on those videos. The Wolf is running it, so you'll know what you want to see. Sort of, it's just a collection of easier to find moments as opposed to scrolling through like 10-hour podcasts and stuff. Mm-hmm. But also keep watching the main podcast too. Like, that's also cool. I'm also okay with that.
Does Zygerian slavers use a light whip in Clone Wars?
Zygerian slavers use a light whip in Clone Wars.
Zygerian slavers.
I don't know if I remember the arc.
Oh.
What season?
Most special. Do not refuse to serve. I will help break it.
The little, yeah.
This thing? Oh, yeah. There you go.
Yeah, you're right. That is how they work. They just fucking open up randomly. Can you go to the? Can you go back? To when it ignited.
That fucking freeze.
I want to see it like if it actually like ignites from a hilt. Yeah, here. Yeah, it's. Yeah. God, it's so retarded, dude.
It's full on just spews out.
That's the thing. There would be like no. There would be no fucking mass. Basically, there would be no fucking mass with that to actually have it whip. If that makes sense, you know what I mean?
Yeah, because it's light.
Yes, which isn't like inherently what makes lightsaber such an interesting weapon, because so little mass other than like directly around the hilt, which is why it's difficult for anyone that's not a Jedi to be able to control.
Have any of you played Hogwarts Legacy? If so, what'd you think? Slytherin Forever. Yeah, it's a fun game. Got a little bit boring.
I missed that one.
Yeah. I liked it. I liked Hogwarts Legacy.
Y'all look up Bible Man. He had a lightsaber, wore superhero attire, and fought the armies of Satan. Now I have no idea how the makers weren't sued. Ghostbusters felt like Nickelodeon show for kids. Bad Batch, X-Men, Walking Dead, Shogun, Invincible airing right now. What?
Yeah, I think Invincible is back, right?
As far as I know, yeah.
Oh, I haven't seen it. Theory, now we are free. I will see you again, but not yet. Not yet. Soon. In Elysium. Theory, your Palpy impression is unparalleled. Send the grift off in style with a quote of your voice for old time's sake. Preferably something funny like, Muy, muy, you sir, boys. Muy, muy, you some boys bombad. Love you guys.
Beautiful.
Or is that supposed to be in Palpatine?
I think so, Palpatine, yeah.
Muy, muy, you some boys bombad.
It feels right. Feels right.
In-game grift lore villains, Leslie Headland, Dave Filoni, K.K. Iger, Hidalgo. Man, we should make a game. So many lightsabers, I'm going to... How do y'all feel about George saying making magic isn't for amateurs? And I've had this video done for literally the day he said it. I just haven't uploaded it because it's a tough one to upload, but I'll probably upload it for tomorrow.
The only issue I take with his entire statement, his entire position, is the making magic is not for amateurs. Because
he was an amateur.
He was an amateur filmmaker, basically. Like, that's the most like, for the guy who is so fed up with the industry and the corporatization of it and the Hollywood regime.
Yeah.
It just seems so antithetical to everything he built his entire career on. And I don't like that statement.
Nope.
But everything else, in terms of, there was a lot of people going really hard on George Lucas for making that statement about Bob Iger, which, say what you want, whatever. Disney stock was about $50 per share when he made that deal. I mean, he's over doubled his money off the deal that Bob Iger gave him. So it's not surprising that he would just have his back, even after all the bullshit that's happened.
I'll miss your show, guys. You have to stick together. Omega Voice. Can y'all talk about the state of storytelling in cinema? Execs ruin every movie compared to 80s, 90s. Writers should ask for more. Producers should ask for more. You know, I think the writers today are just run-of-the-mill diluted. they suck.
I was going to say, I think the problem exists to essentially all tiers now, right? Because we even have comments from higher ups that are interesting in terms of turning the tide. You need some of the bean counters to be like, yo, I need you guys to make me money. However you need to do that, tell some good fucking stories, and then they'll be like, good stories? How do we do that? I've only made, you know, I only was assistant writer on one episode of one TV show 3 years ago. So I don't know exactly how to write a $300 million movie, but I'll give it my best shot. It's like, that could be a mistake too. There's the conversations have happened over many years now. It's this insane rot at almost all levels, almost every way you could imagine how not to create a story. They're basically using as a 101. Like, you should definitely do this with no experience, rush it. Don't even have a script. Always focus on like whatever idea you have first and just work everything toward that quickly, even if you then have to reshoot it entirely and zombify and Frankenstein everything in it, and then just shove it out. Just get it out as quickly as possible.
Multiverse of Madness, yeah.
Ugh.
New Alien movie. Is there a new Alien movie?
Yes.
There was a new trailer, yeah.
Oh.
Mahler loved it. He's really excited.
Oh, I felt very negative in that coverage, but I don't care. I am a scorned Alien fan.
That was the most fucking tired, fed up bullshit I've heard from you in a while, I think. Reaction to that simple trailer.
The thing is, I think I saw and was interested in Alien before Star Wars. Like, that shit goes really far back. And like I said, a strong memory of it is my dad being like, I don't know if you want to see the third one. And I was like, what are you talking about? Like, Alien and Aliens is amazing. I need to see what happens next. And he was like, okay. I was like, what the hell happened?
Should have listened to your father. Good parenting there.
Well, and what's insane, right, is it's that, and then it fails again, and then again, and then again, and then again, and then again. And now we're back to, this trailer looks good, though.
Yeah.
I'm sure the movie will be about as good as Prey. And that's going to be kind of... I've tried to explain this a couple of times to on other streams. I don't want that for that franchise. Alien and Aliens are incredible films. Like, great beyond great beyond great. I don't want them to end up being, what if the alien attacks a bunch of people on a space station that's even bigger than the Nostromo? It's like, okay. What if it attacks them in a jungle? You know, that's different than Predator because it's an alien. What if it attacks a bunch of people in medieval times? What if it attacks a bunch of people?
What if it attacks ancient Egypt?
What if they're on like a moon where the gravity is really limited? That could be interesting. And it's just like, man, I thought Alien was, it was just ready for so much more than that. Mm. There was a, like, Weyland Yutani I find fascinating. And I don't even know if they're going to be fucking mentioned beyond being like a, you know, like a cameo. Like, oh shit, this facility was built by Weyland Yutani and that's it. Like, okay. Like the Burke stuff, all of the politics that happens in Aliens before you even get to like the mission. And then, of course, all the character work, the world building, and then the mystery. I am very much a battered and beaten Alien fan, and seeing that trailer made me sad. And it's like, that's the opposite of what it's supposed to do. And I was like, I know. I really hope it is great. I hope it's fucking great. It would be nice if it was great.
I'm just not a big Alien fan, so it's not like I don't feel as fucking spurned by everything as you do, I guess.
Aliens is like my second favorite film of all time behind Prestige. So it's kind of drawn with like T2. Terminator is exactly the fucking same, by the way, as a franchise. It's kind of insane how much they match.
For people who keep saying they should do something in Old Republic, please stop. It's the last untainted by current regime.
That is true, which is why whenever I like give a pitch to do like a Jedi Mandalorian Wars or something, I say I don't trust anybody to do it, but that would be cool to see.
I'm curious about how Yoda learned about Darth Bane's rule of two, since it was hidden from the Jedi to ensure Sith victory. Maybe Acolyte will show. I hope it doesn't.
Yeah, let's hope Acolyte gets us that piece of lore in there.
Yeah, no, please. You know, Yoda's been alive for so many years, and there was a darkness. There was a dark time that he had, I think. I don't know why I'm thinking of year 400, but I remember reading something, I just can't remember where, that he battled his own darkness too. I mean, imagine being 900 years old. You're going to have some rough days. You're going to have some days where you're like, fuck the world.
I don't even want to live to 50. I couldn't imagine living an entire fucking millennium. Fed up with shit now.
How long would your Annie 3 be on sale. I really want one. I'm saving up for it and just don't want it to go. Oh, dude, don't worry about it, man. So the full site will launch this week or early next week. We're right there. And my God, it is so much work because we don't want to just create something generic. But you guys will see when it's all said and done. No, it'll be up. It'll be up forever. So you're good, man. You're all right. But, you know, with it, with the site, there's coming 120 more options to choose from. And yesterday I just paid for the order quantity for the stands, the Saber stands, and then also the custom limited edition Theory Saber exclusive that should be released May 4th as well. So exciting times, exciting times. And second, would you say it's your one-to-one MR? No. So this is more akin, the Annie 3 is more akin to, so what happened was Lucasfilm used TXQ's Annie hilt for Ahsoka. And so it's a little bit different than ROTS. So it's, but even since then, it's been changed a little bit again. So it's not exactly like the Ahsoka show. However, it's definitely inspired by. You'll have a shit ton of pictures to look from once the full site is up, and videos, and every saber will have. You'll see.
You'll see.
Mahler, why did you stop playing the elevator music when people argue? Theory, have you watched Parasite the Maxim? Will you watch Parasite the Grey? I don't know what that is.
It felt like it was like a 50-50 between, is that the Rags and Wolf music or is that the people argue music? And then it was also like, it had to be really petty arguments. It couldn't be like a fair argument or an interesting one or a quick one. It was like a perfect timing thing. But I think it will come up. I do use it in a Super Chat catch-up that hasn't come out yet because Rags and Fringy argue about something that's, all I remember is it was super retarded and I wasn't paying attention. So I put on music. And I think it got claimed too. But I was like, you know what? It's fucking worth it.
I want Kermit Swayside now. Theory needs to see FNT Binge versus Weekly Debate.
That shit was funny.
The boys are doing more, one more stream together. Love this collaboration. We said last week we're doing one more. Mm-hmm. Hey, Star Wars Theory, Mahler and RK, gonna miss you, gents, during work. It's been great these past few months. To all which Star Wars character would you want to work, would you want to do Death Sticks with? Molly. What's your perfect Sunday?
Oh, so many. My perfect Sunday.
Fucking questions, dude.
What Star Wars character
it's the Hoffa's reference.
Death sticks with?
Jar Jar, right?
It's your perfect Sunday.
Honestly, I kind of want to just get high with Padme and smash. So, Padme.
It's fair. Don't make her too sad, though. She'll die.
Yeah, it's going to happen eventually. Might as well be me that does it.
Perfect Sunday. I don't know. Just fucking hang out with some family, have some fun, friends, talk some media, watch some movies, play some games, go on some adventures.
Long walks by the beach. Theory, have you watched Berserk 97? You're gonna love it. It has a guy with big muscles as the protagonist. Oh yeah, well, that's, you know, that's all it takes for me to love something. I have not seen Berserk 97, dude. I never got Theory to sing the Saga Begins. Maybe I can get him to sing one of Paul Simon's songs about Carrie Fisher. Maybe. Maybe not. You guys will better fucking take Theory's last proposition. Love the show, guys. And Ryan, you want to bang?
Send pics.
There's a 70% chance they won't. But
70.
There's a 30% chance that they might. So, you know, holding on.
I'm interested to know too.
Yeah, it's probably just going to be like a, I don't have time. Mahler, I know we complain about Anakin's fall being too fast. It's just frustrating. I had to get a great explanation why it's so fast in KOTOR.
I need to play KOTOR. So,
what do you mean so fast in KOTOR?
I assume they're saying they played KOTOR and they got an understanding of why it was fast in that, or I don't know.
But Anakin's not in KOTOR.
I mean, I've played KOTOR and I don't really understand the comment necessarily either.
Hmm.
Not sure. One thing I really realized when I was watching Revenge of the Sith is that I need to read the book again, because it's probably been a decade since I read Revenge of the Sith novelization, which goes into so much detail about like kind of the things that are happening, what's in people's minds as it's happening. Like the idea of Mace Windu like sensing fear and like kind of using that to continue to pressure him with his Vapod style, and Palpatine kind of being, well, you think that's my fear that you sense, and him realizing that it's fucking Anakin's fear who's coming. It's just novelization's awesome.
Yeah, that sounds cool. I mean, the thing with me for the prequels is like, we could have had three more movies, like, you know, one between each one, maybe two between like Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith, and one between Phantom Menace and Attack of the Clones, something like that. Like, could there was five, so much more, there's so much more story to do, and I would have loved it with those actors as well. That's one of the things I really appreciate. I don't know how you guys feel about it. Just, Ewan McGregor's Obi-Wan Kenobi, man. He's so
amazing.
Fucking nailed it. Perfect casting and perfect execution. There's nothing, I don't think anyone thinks he damaged Obi-Wan Kenobi. He's like, nope. And it's really cool to have pulled it off, because a lot of the time it just doesn't work when you do a recasting like that.
Yeah.
Especially with someone like Alec Guinness.
Yeah.
Well, that's different. That's the next level shit.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts if they remaster the prequels, redo the VFX in today? No.
It holds up better than shit I'm seeing coming out right now.
Yeah,
like, I just don't see the need. Like,
it looks phenomenal. There's a couple things here and there, obviously, but for the most part, the level of detail on some of these like battle sequences that they have, you know, shots in whether it's a Jedi temple or Padme's apartment or things, and it obviously has a look, right? It has a fairly clean look to it, but in terms of like the style that they were going for, it looks phenomenal. I don't even think they need to touch them.
No. For soundtracks, it's hard to beat Empire with the Imperial March, the Battle of Hoth, the Asteroid Field, Attacking a Star Destroyer, the Bespin theme, and Clash of Sabers.
That's probably my second favorite one.
It's a close fight, honestly. It really is, but I do tend to side with Revenge of the Sith. Mm.
Question for all three of you. What's your favorite MCU film?
Mine's between Civil War and Avengers.
Spider-Man 1, 2001. Was it 2002?
Oh, you mean like Toby Spider-Man?
When they say MCU, I think they mean
Iron Man and after, yeah.
Nope, they can't do that anymore because now Spider-Man is in the MCU.
That is true.
boo. Yeah.
Like, I move around a little bit. Obviously, the first Avengers is fucking amazing. I even think Infinity War is amazing. I like Winter Soldier. You know what? The first Iron Man movie, I don't know if it gets too much more perfect than that. And that was before everything started fucking going insane.
It's true. It's pretty good. Yeah. Yep. First Iron Man movie is great. I mean, I think Infinity War was pretty damn awesome.
I think Infinity War, for as many characters and narratives as they had to weave throughout it, I think it's an amazing fucking movie. Like, when you consider the level of difficulty of weaving all those different personalities and characters and stuff like that within it. Yeah. I think it's a bigger achievement maybe than anything else they had done.
I think that's what everyone had to say when they saw it. It was amazing. We had like three major splinters of all of the big teams, and then they all like, you know, intersected, moved over in different places, and huge payoffs and development. Nice. And it felt really constructed. Then you watch Endgame and it's like a mess.
Yeah.
A complete fucking mess in terms of, and it's just like, oh God, I guess they ran out of time with this one because they were all over the place.
Should have just ended. Just fucking leave half the people dead. That would be better than Endgame.
A lot of people say like, oh, the MCU ended with Endgame, and it's like, it's a way better ending at the end of Infinity War. A really depressing but kind of sort of poignant ending. But the nature of like, you know, sort of minor quibbles and petty differences can actually lead it just enough to destroy almost everything you've built. And you just be more careful. Because, you know, the thing I think that carries from Civil War into Infinity War is that the splintering of the Avengers prevents them from defeating Thanos when they probably could have if they're all together.
Yeah, never picked up the phone. But Infinity War is a good pick. Epic.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah.
Would you guys ever do a stream with Red Letter Media if you could? I think that'd be fun. I don't know if they've ever done a live stream.
I'd do it. They've been on Macaulay Culkin's podcast, but I think that's about as far as they'll go. I assume, I don't know if there's anything like an actual word on this, but I think they avoid collaborations as much as they can. It's
I don't really need to, like,
well, I mean, you know, it's fun is why you can do it, right? But like, I think they avoid it for just the sake of they have a very clean and isolated presence online.
Yeah, that's true.
Volume way too low. Sorry, it's maxed out. Love you guys. You'll always have interesting takes, but who do you want the new James Bond to be? I'm seeing it might be Aaron Taylor Johnson. You know, I thought Henry Cavill could have been good. Idris Elba could have been good. I don't know, man. Daniel Craig and Sean Connery, I just don't think you can really top that ever. So,
I mean, I think that I don't mind if it's Aaron Taylor Johnson, but I don't think he's actually been offered the role. There was a lot of whispers about that last week, and it looks like it may have jumped the gun, or maybe he doesn't want it or something. But Cavill is 40, so Cavill's a little bit old. I think he's perfect for it. I think they should have done it a while ago, but I just don't know. He is also super recognizable, which if you look back at the history of James Bond castings, they're not going out there and casting like A-listers typically. Sure. You know, Pierce Brosnan was doing fucking Remington Steel, you know, when he got offered to do Bond. So,
yeah,
I don't know. I'm fine with Aaron Taylor Johnson. I think he's like 33 or 34. I have no idea who it's going to be.
Brennan Mahler should write their own comic book.
I'm not much of a writer.
I guess I'll go fuck myself then. Finally started watching Game of Thrones. Ed Stark seems like such a good dude. Can't wait to watch 8 seasons of this guy.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
He has a really great arc all throughout. You lose your mind. What starfighter would you choose if they were real?
Bro.
Wait.
The Adi Mundi's throbbing head.
That face.
It's a picture of Theory. With cum on top of his head.
Hey, it's icing.
It's cream.
It's icing. Why am I crying?
Yeah.
I'm not even going to answer that, man. Fuck.
Let's start with Chiss Clawcraft. How about that?
Mahler, I've been bringing all your EFAP streams from episode one, binging episode one lately. Got to a particular episode. I'm curious, do you still believe water is wet?
Yes. I disagree with Rags on the fundamentals. We have this whole debate over is water makes things wet, therefore it cannot be wet, but you never encounter water in any other position than being surrounded by water. Therefore, water is always wet. Water, if you go down to the particle and say, yes, yeah, see, it's not making things wet. It makes things wet. It isn't wet itself. It's like nobody feels or experiences water at the particle. They always have it in, even a droplet is already way more. And that is, to me, is like, that's what we call water. And that's what is wet. It is, water is wet.
Isn't there like a Derek Zoolander quote we could use for this?
Yeah. But
what is it like? Water is the essence of
moisture.
Water
is the essence of moisture.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Merman.
Merman.
Speaking of things that didn't need sequels.
Zoolander, you know what would be hilarious if we had a stream one day where all of us were dressed up as Zoolander characters? I think you and I could be Hansel and Derek, and then Mahler would have to be Mugatu.
That'd be funny. Bro, on Zoolander 2, when he fucking rips off that fucking like muscle suit.
Wait, I didn't see Zoolander 2.
Don't. It's bad.
Yeah, I didn't see it. The one scene in Obi-Wan's initial attack on Maul felt so much more violent and authentic than any pitter-patter shit we've gotten in years. It feels dangerous and you're able to feel it differently. Well, dude, that is Nick Gillard, man. That's like...
Yeah, like, you know, the choreography in the prequels is just fucking next level.
It can't be beat.
It's kind of ironic too, because in the sequels they argued they were going for like a rougher you know,
they're raw, away. They're untrained. Yeah.
Yeah, well, they're failed. So. Keep in mind when they're doing this, they're using actual
like sticks, metal, right?
Metal blades,
yeah. Metal beams, and you get whacked in the face.
Or the hand,
yeah.
Knuckles.
I mean, like in the back of the head, like just imagine, you know?
Yeah. And like, there is nothing from any era of Disney Star Wars that competes with this.
Nope.
What's the best one we've gotten, do you think?
Oh, that's a good question. What is the best duel in the sequels? Well, Disney content.
In Disney canon period, so we can bring in, like, I think most people's answer is probably going to be Anakin Ahsoka. I think that maybe the next one would be, what's his nuts? Ray Stevenson's character and Ahsoka, I guess, would be the next one. Like, I don't know, man.
There's, which was still bad.
I wasn't
a fan of those, but I guess they're better than the sequels.
Yeah, like, that's what I'm saying, like, by process of elimination.
Yeah.
It just seems so slow. Like, watch this, and then watch those.
Dude, watching the... do you remember the Rey Kylo one in Rise of Skywalker where, like, they're like... The way their lightsabers unclash is really fucking strange. Like, they both keep doing, like, a... they like break apart really oddly over and over again. And then of course, like she starts, I don't even know why she was losing that one. It doesn't even make sense considering everything we do. And then she loses, she wins.
I like this one, to be honest. Where's Lord Vader? I might be biased a little bit, but...
Do you want to claim Disney canon on that one?
On mine?
Yeah.
No. That's my own universe. That's my own spin. There's no Disney influence whatsoever. At all.
Video games count? Of course not.
No. Thank you for all being humble, civil, and giving thousands of people entertainment. You guys are doing great things. Oh, thanks, Sinister Reviews. Whoa, biggest super chat of the day from Corey. He says, yo, gents, have really enjoyed watching the streams with you three. You each have a different and unique take on Star Wars, which makes for fun and dynamic conversations. We'll be seeing you all on your other channels. Right on.
Thank you.
Thanks, man. Pre-Vizsla Darth Maul fight in Clone Wars, top 5 of all time. That one was pretty good, yeah.
It's tough, it's tough to count any animated duel just because you are... obviously, you're limited physically what you can do, whereas you can do pretty much anything you want. Yeah. Oh, did you see? Hold on. I don't know if you see Savage Opress right there, Mahler.
I've seen this before, yeah.
Okay.
That's the Savage.
You see the original one?
What's the original one? Unfinished.
Sense of presence.
Oh my
the
God.
The spin.
But with both.
I love how he's walking.
Just sends lightning through his face.
I am awful, the Sith.
Look, he's getting away. Stop him.
He's smart. He leads them into like a one camera.
He pulled a 300 on him.
Yeah. That was it.
So hold on. Can you go back 1 second?
Yeah.
And at how pointless. Not the air, but so when Savage comes down and he plants his lightsaber in the ground, basically, and then has his like the other lightsaber guarding his face, Palpatine, it's after this. It's back when it's to the regular animation.
Oh,
it's right after they do their superhero landing.
So this,
just a couple seconds before. Just let it play from here. Watch Savage go down and like plant his lightsaber in the ground. He's got his other blade up, and Palpatine, for no reason whatsoever, just slams directly into his lightsaber. He let them go down. Right. Here, look at Savage. Look at that. Look at the fucking sick lightsaber ignites to block it. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. I think he said for no reason.
Yeah, what about it?
But, like, what I mean is he takes both fucking lightsabers and about to fucking hammer him.
I feel like that's been a problem throughout all of Star Wars. Anyone that has two blades versus one, it's always been like a, Like, man, you know, General Grievous.
Like, what is the, like, exactly, when you have another opponent right there, what is the point of trying to slap both of your lightsabers through their fucking, especially on the same plane? Now, if you're going to come around and do something like this that makes sense, then it might be unblockable. But like both lightsabers, same plane, fucking right next to
each other. Oh shit.
That's what I mean.
I think your channel's this has been blocked. Chat is saying the stream's down.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, it's copyright. You showed
so much of this. Yeah.
Just wait for a little bit. Just stop showing it, it'll come back up.
What a joke.
Stream should be back now. So you just gotta, you can't play it for too long or it does that. For anybody that missed the conversation, we were talking about how Palpatine basically takes both his fucking lightsabers and holds them right next to each other to try to fucking slash through Savage Opress instead of doing something else with another one of his lightsabers.
He's evil.
He's evil, but he's also fucking really smart.
I don't believe I heard your take on the creator of God of War not liking Kratos' arc in the Norse games. Any thoughts?
Yeah, he said something along the lines of don't inject your own like experiences and lives into the character just because the creators at the time had kids and that changed their lives. They shouldn't then force Kratos to have a kid and have his life change as a result of it, which I find complete horseshit considering he's dealt with two different kids in the original games and series already. So he's already had the father experience, and the moving on and having a new one to explore that part of his character just doesn't assassinate or contradict anything at all. I have no idea what the big issue is. If people want to highlight problems with the storyline or the characterization itself, go right ahead. But the concept of Kratos being a father, we've already had several examples, being his original kid and then like how he behaves with Pandora. God of War 3, as far as I'm concerned, if everybody rewatches how that game goes and how it ends, sets up all of the Norse era. There's no contradictions. There's no like, oh no, you're ruining it by not having him kill everybody like mindlessly or something. It's like, no, watch it. Right at the end, you can see all of the setup for Kratos' arc is about to begin significantly. He doesn't exactly enjoy or think well of his decisions throughout the first three games.
Yeah.
I love God of War. All of them pretty much.
Great character arc. I enjoyed it.
But at the same time, I understand the criticism of like, don't just inject yourself into a character. But I just don't believe that's what they did. I think that they focused hard on what they were doing with Kratos. They didn't just throw themselves in.
I fully agree. Yeah, don't inject yourself into a character that's already established. But I think in this case, like you said, it makes sense. It's good.
People are still saying it's blocked, by the way.
Is like the whole stream down?
No, a lot of people are saying it's back. I guess it's coming back at different intervals for people.
Oh, yeah. Some people are saying it's back,
That's so weird. You can't even like react to anything, even if it's on mute.
Mm.
Which is strange. Even I reacted to that whole video, so it's like.
I mean, there are ways, right? Like the ways we try to do it is you put up an image at like half opacity, and then you mute, and you can basically play it. It looks awkward, but that's about as well as you can do it without them taking you down.
Bizarre.
Yeah, it's up for me. So.
Good.
Whatever. got blocked twice, but back now. Okay. Well, make sure you hit like button while you're here. Hey all, Mahler and Ryan, has there ever been a movie series that made you guys cry? Yeah, for me, Gladiator and Last Samurai. We'll miss you both. Thank you for your entertainment.
Always reference T2's ending. That gets to me almost every time.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, anytime there's a fucking, like, children or a dog involved, you know, might get some tears out of me.
Watching you three talk about the prequel trilogy really makes me miss feeling positive about Star Wars. Indeed.
Yeah, I mean, to sort of tangent on that sort of thing, I'm with you, and I like talking positively and hypely about, you know, like IPs. And so you just got to kind of find the ones that are still feeding you worthwhile content to dig into and discuss and stuff. And I'd say, like, that's what me and Ryan are very hyped about with Hot D. It's like, that's going to start up, and we're going to be able to do weekly streams just talking about how fucking awesome it is. Hopefully.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna be talking about Hot D as well, if anyone is interested, but it'll be on my Fantasy Theory channel, and it'll be with my friend Nick. Him and I will be discussing it in different videos. So that's nice. Where I discuss, like, anything pop culture that's not Star Wars.
Have you watched season one yet?
No, not yet.
Got to get out. Well, I guess you got to tell June.
I got to get out. Yeah. She can't do that. Shoot her or something.
Patience, Viceroy. Patience. She will die.
God.
In spite of your differences, you talk to each other respectfully about something that we all grew up loving and want to love again. That's what's missing right now in all of our countries. Yeah, I would even say that we don't really have that vast of a difference on things. Just maybe, what, like Andor?
I think there's some pretty big differences in how we look at, like, pretty much any Star Wars stuff. And I think all of us value different things in some ways.
Yeah.
But,
sure.
Yeah.
I think we're able to format the conversation so that we all feel like we're on the same wavelength. We just have different experiences and values, right? Like, in terms of what we...
Yeah, like the whole, like, Anakin turning to the dark. Yeah, like, yeah. Yeah.
Well, something you brought up Andor. I feel like all three of us have a different POV on Andor and how much we like it, right? It's like, and they very much can't coexist in the sense of what you like and don't like. But at the same time, we can easily talk about them.
Yeah, there's no bearing on these guys being my friends or not. It's just like, I don't know. I think people today, like, you have to be friends with people who have the same beliefs and same views as you. And I just think it's super lame.
It's lame.
Yeah, that's like having the Avengers in that case would be everyone would be Captain America or everyone would be Iron Man. It's like, well, what the hell is that? It's just Ultron.
Yeah, it's need diversity.
But like the real diversity, because it's like,
like actual adversity. Release the 6-hour cut of Phantom Menace.
That'd be cool. Do it.
Fuck yeah.
Was about to listen to Binary Sunset before I go to bed, but it's safe to assume Disney is going to rename that track to Non-Binary Sunset.
It's pretty funny.
It's possible. I tried to appreciate the latest episode, but I really didn't like Fennec Shan's attitude. I like her in Book of Boba Fett, but not her attitude in this episode. Yeah, Book of Boba Fett, she's a little more personable, a little more reasonable. In Bad Batch, she's more, like, snooty and arrogant, I'd say. Elitist.
I would say she's a little, like, cold. Yeah. I feel like that feels more like her character was in the little we saw of her in Mandalorian. I think Book of Boba Fett, she took a turn.
Do you have the willingness and capability of making custom sabers? I do, yeah. That's how Theory Saber started, making custom ones. We're releasing a new custom one May 4th. Found out in November my wife has cancer. It's not terminal. Oh, that's good.
Ooh.
And feel like she needs a saber with a pink cancer awareness blade. Money is not an issue. Oh, I mean, well, first of all, I'm happy to hear that it's not terminal. I hope she'll make a good, quick recovery. But also, all of the blades are RGB, so you can change it to whatever you want. But if you're talking about the hilt to be pink, yeah, I'd love to make a cancer awareness saber. It'd be sweet, and then we could, like, donate a big chunk of the profits to breast cancer research. That could be something we can look at down the line, for sure. Yeah. The thing is, with that, I would have to make a minimum order quantity, so it would be like, you know, I'd have to make a minimum of, you know, a few hundred of them. We could probably do that. When is Breast Cancer Awareness Month? Or just, is there a Cancer Awareness Month?
October.
Tuesday, October 1st to October. Yeah, so we could do something lined up probably for October. Something like that. That could be cool.
I'm a cancer encyclopedia. Yeah, I'm sorry to hear about your wife, though, man. I'm glad it's not terminal or anything, but still a lot to go through.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm really happy. Episode 2, also the best names.
Sleazebag, I know, is a good one.
Mahler, I agree with your take on the Yoda and Palpatine fight in Revenge of the Sith. Remember when RLM said that George ruined the Force and used that scene as an example? Excuse for covering the Disney Star Wars.
Yeah, I don't, like I said, I think we mentioned this on a previous Star Wars. I don't see what they do in that scene as anything past what we thought was possible with the Force. I think RLM also take issue with Yoda even having a lightsaber. So,
which is silly.
I don't want to misquote, but I think he said something like you just don't expect a Yoda to feel the need to even have one in the first place or something. And I remember thinking like, I don't know if I buy that. Like, you know, cause you don't see his lightsaber in the OT, but that doesn't mean that he never used one or anything.
I don't have a problem with him using a saber. I think it's cool. I think it's so badass how he conserves his energy and walks with the cane and then uses all of the power of like 900 years of the Force and just like becomes the most deadly weapon with a saber.
Yeah,
he reverts back to being tired.
He's at a point in his life and his career that he doesn't need a lightsaber very often at all. He shouldn't, right? But absolutely, he's a Jedi. He's still going to have one. Like, my guess is that he, did he ever recover his lightsaber that he dropped in the duel? Probably not, right?
Probably not.
Yeah, and even if he had, if you're in hiding and you're pretty resigned to being in hiding, I don't even think you're going to bring, you wouldn't want to have that. Look at what Obi-Wan did, right? He fucking buried his for a while.
Buried his shit, yeah. What's up, It's Officials? To the last of a very fun, very short-lived podcast, keep it crumming, Ryan. You will never escape that salacious burn.
Salacious bum.
I don't think he wants to. My sister Queens will miss this show.
Thank you, Darth Shanene.
Alas, does this mean we'll never get Mahler introducing Theory to play Akbar's theme? I did. A couple streams ago.
He's aware of it. It's just an EFAT meme. It's a good one.
$20 ain't much, but I've been watching Rule of Two since the OG mark, and whatever that guy's name was, I remember his dog's name was Leia, but for sure, y'all have been the most entertaining group to watch talk Star Wars.
Thank you, Abalorian.
Thanks, bro. Thanks for reading the super chats last week. Almost forgot, but sending the note to my future self helped. P.S. Salacious will miss this podcast. Now what will we watch while hugging his RK Elk post body pillow?
Man, only two of those sold, so it's good to know that you are that Salacious Crumb has one of them.
He has both of them.
Yeah, when he has to wash it. Yeah, because all the crumbs, you know.
Yeah.
He doesn't wash it, dude.
He crumbs all over that pillow.
He definitely washes it. The three of you, when you disagree on something, remind me of my brothers and I. During Thanksgiving, we don't yell at each other about politics. We yell about Star Wars. There you go.
Fuck yeah.
Is it really?
I don't think we've yelled too much on the podcast.
No.
We've had some memes.
Me occasionally, but that's about it.
Reject soy wars, embrace the expanded universe.
Yeah.
When the Jedi or Sith fart, do they create an unintentional force push? Also, if force users gain weight, do they get more powerful due to increase in mass? Yes to both questions.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's actually like a very, like, if you have more cells in your body, if you get fatter, are you getting more cells?
I mean, you are, but when you get more midichlorians, it's up to whoever's writing the lore, I guess.
I would say no. I'd say you get more fat cells, but you don't get more midichlorian cells.
Yeah. So they're like, the theory goes that, you know, once Anakin lost part of his arm, he's still obviously fucking super powerful, but when he lost part of his arm, he may have lost a tiny bit of that force potential as well that he could have possibly had if he had stayed intact the entire time. Same with Luke and shit. So it's an interesting theory to be like, if you got really fucking fat, could you potentially
just picturing like
have more midichlorians?
This poor Jedi, this, you know, he's like teenager era. He finds out about midichlorians, misunderstands them, gets like overeats like crazy. And then 10 years later, Yoda explains it to him. He's like, oh,
you see, it? He's like, he like sneaks into the Jedi Council chamber and steals Yoda's fucking hover round thing.
And it's like collapsing under his weight.
Yeah, it's like he's just skimming off the floor.
He's just like scraping the interior of the Jedi Temple.
Dude, that's hilarious.
And then there's a deleted scene of Anakin tracking him down and killing some fat fuck.
Yeah. Slowly hilarious. Hovering away while Anakin's walking toward him.
I have to make that into an animation. That's actually hilarious.
Lizzo must have great potential. Yeah.
Goodbye, Weekly Stargrift. Looking forward to watching again for the big releases like The Acolyte. By the way, love the prequels and have been looking forward to the discussion. Right on. Yeah. Thanks, man. We don't say no homo, we say no Diddy.
Yeah, Diddy's house got raided apparently by the feds.
Damn.
A lot of gay sex going on there.
Really?
That's the story.
Oh.
Why not, I guess?
If Yoda was at the Jedi Temple during Order 66, could he have stopped Anakin? Yes. I did a fan fiction where he went to Mustafar.
Obi-Wan would have got slaughtered by Palpatine.
Yeah, he would have been dead. Chatamane. Forrest Gump sucks. Long live the grift.
Keep that Forrest Gump. This has got it
out for Forrest Gump. Yeah.
Thanks, Cody. Is there a chance of discussing the books more in detail? I love most of the books, but I don't feel like I hear people talk about them so much. Yeah, I mean, well, I have a playlist which goes over lots of cool snippets from different Star Wars novels. I'm hoping Ryan does something similar too one day.
I should.
Bon voyage.
Thank you.
Thanks.
you read the name?
Yeah.
Yeah, go back. It's an appropriate name. Well, it's not really. There's nothing wrong. Figure Nagget is the name of that super chatter. So within YouTube's terms of service, apparently.
Who do you guys think was the most underused in the prequels? Who do you think was used just the right amount? Underused is probably Count Dooku or Plo Koon.
A lot of people say Maul.
I was going to say that'd probably be
the most popular answer if you ask people.
Probably.
Dooku, Maul, and Grievous. I would vote all three of them in that. I wish I had more of all of them. But I think that stacks in order, like Maul the most, then Dooku, then Grievous. And then who's used the just the right amount? Probably Palpatine.
You know, what if like... what if we had gotten an extra like hour of Phantom Menace and you kind of get introduced to a little bit more like the behind the scenes shit going on at the temple and Dooku is still there and like Dooku's involved and everything.
Yeah, that'd be cool. Yeah.
And then you see like, and he's like upset at an action or whatever. And then Qui-Gon dies and you see him like blow up at Yoda and leave the Jedi Order.
Yeah. Yeah. Who's your favorite character from the prequels, and why is it Darth Jar?
you automatically fill in Darth Jar Jar.
Yeah, I don't know why I said Darth Jar Jar.
Because that's his correct form. Wait, don't you want to answer that question? Or
I said Qui-Gon.
Oh. Really? He's your favorite from the prequels? I thought it was Anakin.
Yeah, Anakin's overall, I'd say, but Qui-Gon is, like, I think, probably the who you'd want to be. You know?
Yeah, I mean, probably Obi-Wan. Like Obi-Wan's,
I think mine's
probably
Obi-Wan
my
as well.
Yeah, I mean, I fucking love Anakin, but
yeah,
you get to see Ewan in all three.
Yeah. Ryan, how much? It'll only take a minute or two.
How much?
Batches?
The Dawn is a big fan of. The crew of Acolyte Def took gender studies.
Yeah.
Probably. Thanks for the streams, boys. What's up, Sand? Thank you for everything, guys. Theory, hit me up if you need someone to talk Star Wars with. Star Wars is alive and well in the EU and in the first six films.
What's up, Angry Badger?
Any good Boba Fett comic stories? I once heard Boba Fett was originally going to be Anakin's brother. I have not heard this. But apparently Obi-Wan has a brother.
What?
Yeah, from the Obi-Wan show.
I don't even remember that. What?
Obi-Wan's brother from...
What's his name?
He's talking to Leia. He's like talking about his brother.
I don't even remember that.
Yeah, it was pretty stupid. I didn't like it.
How would he even remember? I mean, I guess maybe he could.
Obi-2.
Obi-2. Obi-Wan had a brother over on Stujon, huh? I just missed that. His name was Daryl.
Daryl Kenobi.
Glimpses. Flashes, really. My mother's shawl. My father's hands. I remember a baby.
A baby?
Yes, I think I had a brother.
Okay,
I don't remember him. I wish I did. Then I joined the Jedi and I got a...
I forgot all about that sequence, yeah.
Maybe it's General Grievous. Wouldn't that be a great twist?
No, he's a different species.
What do you mean? That doesn't stop it. Like, it could make sense.
Sad to see you guys.
What if they had Omega's blood and they combined with Grievous's skeleton and Obi-Wan's hair? You know, like if you get it all in.
And Omega's accent.
It just makes sense.
Oh, God.
And that gets you Daryl 2 Kenobi.
Sad to see you guys go. I'm loving these streams. Might as well give you mine. Host hot pastrami, toasted rye, salt and pepper, Swiss cheese, mustard, pickles, banana peppers, and crispy onions. God bless. I bet you someone from the stream is going to go make that sandwich.
Oh, yeah.
I bet you.
That doesn't sound too bad.
They got to know what it tastes like.
Sounds freaking awesome. Mm. Every time I hear from people doing Acolyte, it's nothing but DEI. Yet others get pissy when you notice the thing. Sorry to see this end, but keep up the great work. Ray Trailer for a mil dislikes.
I wouldn't be surprised.
Wouldn't be surprised either. Get big ideas and intellectuals as guests theory?
Big ideas and intellectual. Yeah, the philosophers.
They're philosophers?
Yeah, Bigidius. He's one of the Roman ones.
What I feel like you're trolling.
Take me fucking 10 years to explain the EFAP memes. I'd rather just go with like the end game, which is very famous philosophers, yes.
Bigidius. Can you read this one? I'm going
to
sneeze.
Last Star Grip. Enough to make a grown man cry. I blame Disney. They put out so much vile dog shit. Long man cannot keep up.
Pretty much.
Andrew Foster.
Get Chris Stuckman as a new host.
Ooh. Hell yeah.
Interesting.
Who's that?
He's a film reviewer. He might be a little bit busy as well, but hey, it'd be fun.
What are the absolute worst lightsaber duels from anything and why those? Episode 789.
Yeah, anytime I see Rey and Kylo clashing blades, I think it's really watch. Painful. Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty horrible.
I think there was some, like, obviously, Mahler spent a lot of time talking about the Last Jedi throne room fight and everything. I think there's some, like, interesting ideas, like, in that scene. And I think it's just the most poorly executed shit you can imagine. It's like they did one take and we're like, ah, fuck it, we'll fix it in post.
Yeah, literally, but yet we won't.
Yeah.
How would you make a Star Wars L4D game? Death Troopers or, like, Vong Slaves or something? Shame it's over.
Left 4 Dead?
Oh, that I was gonna say, what the fuck is L4D?
That makes sense.
Yeah, I guess you could do zombie stormtroopers. but I don't know. I haven't played too much Left 4 Dead, so
yeah. I mean, it's not features. There's a set of main classes. You could probably find Star Wars equivalents for a lot of them. Smokers. I'm not sure. Maybe that would be Jar Jar Binks. You need a really long tongue, so that could work. Zombie Jar Jar.
Me's gonna eat you.
For sake of conversation, can you all three, can you list your top 3 to 5 Jedi and why? I'll give you a quick rundown. Qui-Gon, Anakin, and I'm gonna go with Dooku today. Qui-Gon because he doesn't take shit. He doesn't listen to the council. Anakin because he's Anakin, and then Dooku because he also follows his own ideas and found out that the Jedi were actual pawns of the political game.
Mine's gonna be Grandmaster Luke Skywalker, actual Luke Skywalker from the EU. Jason Solo, Kip Duran, Corin Horn, and Kyle Katarn. There you go. That's my top five. I reserve the right to change the order, though.
Yep.
And also the list.
I would probably gun for, I guess, the Anakin Vader overall idealized vision of that story and what it means. And then the same for Count Dooku. With as little as I think there is to gain just from the movies, there's still so much about what you know about him that I think is fascinating. And I could do with a fucking movie all about Count Dooku. Like, it's there's just so much to work with. And then, Luke, just OT Luke. I've always loved his story.
You still got to watch Tales of the Jedi.
That's a short watch moment.
Cheers, fellas, to a great run. I'll keep watching you all separately and for the reunions. Much love. Much love, dude.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining. Isn't it funny that Disney got George Lucas to come in and say making Star Wars isn't for amateurs? Meanwhile, the showrunners are literally bragging about hiring writers who've never seen Star Wars. Indeed. Disney knows it is having a quality issue with Marvel and Star Wars. The question is, why won't they change, especially when it comes to all the lost money? I don't know why they won't change. Politics and agendas. You guys think Venestra Rowe will use her light whip? Yeah, it's confirmed.
100%.
Is Stargriff ending because of conflicting schedules? Sad to see it end, but it was fun while it lasted. Yeah, the boys have a lot going on.
He's got a lot of shit going on, yeah.
Well, it's not really people saying, like, Maul got burned out. It's like, no, I'm the complete opposite. I'm firing all cylinders. I'm on all kinds of shows and making all kinds of videos. It's just that I can't fit in another one. I wanted to try. And you know what? I'm glad we got the 14 episodes with specials to come as opposed to zero. You know, like, instead of just blocking it out entirely, it was fun that we did it.
Yeah.
I'd rather think of it that way.
Yeah. We need to see Feral Ryan for the last time.
Maybe if you stick around to the end.
Please sub to Mahler and Ryan's channels. Yeah, they're linked in the description. You can refresh the stream if you need to, but they're there. I've been making my way through Return of the Jedi EU. I'm on book 17 of the NJO series. Is the Jaden Core duology any good? Also, Ryan mentioned after NJO, Kip doesn't play a big role in the story. Such a shame.
Yeah, so the Jaden Core duology is interesting. They're not my favorite books, but I like Jaden Core because he's your character from Jedi Academy game and shit like that. I enjoy them, but they're a departure from the kind of very structured series that are coming before. You can read both of them almost as standalones between Riptide and Cross Current. I think that's the name of those. But Kip does not play a massive role in the story afterwards, which is a waste because he's a badass.
All three of you guys are incredibly passionate fans. Love watching your content. Thank you. Have you guys checked out Severance Season 1 from Season 1 to 2? Underrated shows with a lot of good stuff. I have not.
I think that's an Apple TV show. I have yet to check it out.
Homer Simpson, this one's for you. The dono is the same color as your skin. 8 out of 19 in NJO, and Vector Prime was really good. I cried at the death and the funeral of Chewie. Manly tears.
There you go. Spoiler warning out there. But yes, thank you. And thank you, Rossi.
Did you hit 300K?
I did, yeah, the other day.
Oh, chat, we got to give him some, I don't know, some balloons or something, like a cake. Cake emoji in the chat. Just
spam. Yeah. Celebration, fireworks, something like that. Thank you, guys. I appreciate it.
Good job.
Thanks.
I think George's direction and revenge is the strongest. I love how the movie flows, but the score is so beautiful and the CGI mostly holds up too. Always love you guys together. Thanks, Zed. That's nice.
Thanks, Zed.
Yeah.
Yeah, the way I've always viewed George is that he is I think is a fantastic storyteller. Like, I don't think his strength is as a filmmaker necessarily. I think his strength is storytelling. But I do think that Revenge of the Sith by far is like the best of the prequels when it comes to filmmaking as well.
I agree. The next Star Wars movie should begin with a character standing over a handsome a headstone that reads. So I was looking at Ryan and I just got confused. Over a headstone that reads Rey Skywalker and saying, "This will begin to make things right." Jeez.
That'd send a message, huh?
Damn. Did you hear about some inappropriate touching Hayden? Someone inappropriate touching Hayden in Indianapolis Comic Con? No, I did not.
Didn't hear anything about it.
It's weird. Let me pull it up.
Is it? I hope it's someone inappropriately touching him. That's what I hope the story is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm sure.
Not that I want Hayden to have to go through something like that. I'm just saying.
No.
Rossi for $5 says, best sabers on the market. It's no theory. www.theorysabers.com.
Can chat tell us something about this? Did someone touch him weird?
I don't know.
Hey, thanks, Rossi. I would use, and sorry to everyone who's been wanting Theory Talk streams every night and streams on the gaming channel. We're pretty much in the end game now for the site to launch. And once the site launches, you know, I'll have more time. But right now it's crunch time, baby. There's a lot of work that we still have to do. I would use Siruk Tech to put Vong into machines or graft machines onto Vong to be kind them.
Mm. That'd be weird.
Check out Jed Ward. What is that?
Thank you, Birdman. Apparently he's cool.
Is that the Anakin thing?
I have no idea. He's just somebody spamming check out Jed Ward.
Oh, Jesus. I haven't been around much lately, but I do catch the streams on replay. I just want to say I didn't like many of the people on before Mahler and Ryan, and I'm really going to miss you guys. I like these guys a lot, man.
We're going to miss you too, X-Ace.
Yeah. I used to like you, Mahler. Giving us Ryan, funniest YouTuber alive, theory, still full of hope, and you together was everything. I didn't know I needed it in my life. Then you got overwhelmed. Sigh.
I'm sorry.
I used to like you until you couldn't do this stream anymore, Mahler. You fuck. Thank you, badass, for the compliment.
Did you ever hear back from Hayden after Orlando? Let him know you're looking for a new co-host, eh? I think Disney might have something to say about that. Yeah, well, he said next time he's in Vancouver, so. Rest in piss, Pendejos. Gonna miss the show.
Pendejos. Spanish.
Why don't they ever hire Pete? Oh, God.
Pendejos.
Why don't they ever hire people that write? Well, just put it one word. Why did you put it two words?
He may have had to space it because YouTube wouldn't let him type it.
Oh. Why don't they ever hire people that write stories for games to write for these projects? They seem to get things right most of the time. Theory, have you seen Dune 2? I did, yeah. I'm firing up the Movie Bros channel again, so... be prepared for some movie reviews. The first one is going to be immaculate. Word is Keanu makes a cameo in Acolyte, possibly as Revan, I'd assume, in an explanation of Sith history.
I think it's a bullshit rumor.
Yeah, I don't think it's real.
But maybe.
Would it be cool? I think Omega will secretly teach Crosshair the Force. They won't know at first, but them meditation, I could see it, and would make Crosshair get his aim back. You know, it's funny. When I make a video about the Acolyte, it's like, you know, 100 to 200,000 views. When I do the breakdowns for the Bad Batch, it's like 50,000. Like, no one, 70,000.
No one's watching it, yeah.
No one's watching the Bad Batch.
It's just, there's just not as big of an audience or a care factor for the Star Wars animation. And I know this channel's full of people that fucking love Clone Wars, but the level of interest in it is not the same
as
the live action stuff.
I would disagree. I'd agree, but I disagree. I'd say just for Clone Wars. There's a huge, huge audience. But any other animation besides Clone Wars, like Bad Batch, even Tales of the Jedi, you know, that did pretty well. When
do,
I was making,
do you know, it, do you know why nobody had any idea what the fuck was going on when Darth Maul showed up in Solo? It's because the general Star Wars audience is not familiar with the Clone Wars.
Yeah.
Now your audience is, because your audience is full of people that really fucking care about Star Wars.
Yeah, there's a big mix of people. Yeah. But yeah, no, I know. Yeah. I think Omega will secretly teach Crosshair. Oh, I read this one.
Crosshair.
If you need a co-host, I'm your guy. My fave character is Reva and the Force is female. We could have some interesting debates. Probably. Farewell, Stargrift. It's been fun.
Walrus Jedi Gaming. Thank you.
Sweet. Right.
What's up, boys? Hate this is the last stream with all of you, but best of luck to Ryan and Mauler with everything. Just got my Maul Saber. It's everything I wanted. Oh, I'm glad you like it, dude. Remember, if you do a review, I'll be giving you guys discount codes. So if you post a review on YouTube, like a full review unboxing and everything, I'll give you guys discount codes to your next Saber. And that's something we're rolling out with the full site. So if I see it,
nice.
Then yeah, I'll be sending you guys. I haven't figured out the percentage yet. Most likely, probably it's going to be 10%. So, which is a big chunk. I mean, you buy a $500 Saber, it's $50. Sup, boys? Hate this is the last stream with all of you. Best of luck. Did I just read this? I did. I'm losing my mind. The Force ain't female. Dumb. Ryan, it's when, if Uthura bans, turns back to the light, and then tells her story and how she fell through noble intentions.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I guess. Like, I don't recall specifically what that conversation's about, but I could see what you mean if you're talking about seeing her through Anakin. Best of intentions type of thing.
Blue Eyed says, review this.
What is it?
it's
oh, yeah.
Review this. wetness is a liquid's ability to adhere to a solid, Mauler. Water can't adhere to itself.
No, it's not. Wetness is a liquid's ability to adhere to a solid. You can have like oil and water together, right? And there'll be a combination of liquids, not that they adhere. There's all different,
does water make oil wet?
My point is that there's all different kinds of adhering, you know, from zero to full. I don't know when does the adherence not qualify, I guess, if you're holding it together. Besides, as far as let me check the wetness definition.
All right, so the state or condition of being covered or saturated with water or another liquid.
Yeah.
Saturated with water.
You do not encounter water in any other state than it being surrounded by more water. That's how we interact with water all the time. You don't interact with it on like an individual particle level, like H2O. That's just not how water works.
H2O.
Remember, because people are citing the definition, it's not just saturated, it's covered. So, oil surrounded by water would count as the state or condition as being wet by that definition.
What's up, Theory?
Hey, they wanted the autism fight. They got it.
Guys, what am I doing to you to make all my co-hosts leave?
He demanded I send him a sex tape of me butt-fucking Salacious Crumb.
He forced me to explain how
water. And I refused. Yeah. Those are for me and my personal use. And I just felt really uncomfortable with it. So.
Yeah, sorry. Sorry,
but
guys.
Mostly it's because, you know, we kind of got into this and it was fun, but me and Mauler both have a lot of shit going on. So we just can't do it weekly like this. That's really the explanation.
They're just covering for me, guys. So
we are. Theory is very abusive.
Yeah.
And every time I insult Dave Filoni, he attacks me.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
Physically.
Yeah, I show up at his house
with a lightsaber.
Annie 3.
I call this the Salacious.
Whips me with it. Gets out a light whip.
All right, my guess is Alan Dean Foster. Have you heard you're looking for a designer, and I've got a bachelor's degree and 4 years of experience, including working for pro sports leagues. Where's the best place to send up before a designer? I'm not looking for a designer.
Harambe-esque.
I appreciate that, though. If I will be, I'll let you know. Wet is a description for the state of liquid. Water is liquid, therefore water is always wet.
This guy knows what's up. He wants my cereal. We should get it to him.
Came down on him. Down on who?
On you. When you got banned. Yeah, when the stream got suspended.
Yeah.
That's happened to me plenty of times doing like trailer or watching parts of movies or something. They take it down temporarily. They don't like strike your channel or they just take it down and let you know, hey, don't play it.
Yeah. Marlar, I know you don't read, but I highly recommend Alien Earth War Cherbids Cold Forge. There are audiobooks in Gibson's Alien 3 audio dramas.
It's not that I don't read, it's that I can't read. It's very different, but thank you for the recommendation. I might check it out. Who knows?
Darth Mickey Mouse is on the hunt for Jedi. Then all they're going to find are Sith. Stream died for a few minutes, boys. Welcome back.
Thank you.
So far back we are. Jango Fett versus Predator. Who wins? Jango Fett.
Predator.
Fuck no. Stop showing clips.
Fucking Jango got nearly beat by like a little dinosaur.
Okay. That was just stupid. I was talking to Nick about that. He's like, it was pretty stupid how he died. He's like, he just wanted to be dead. He's like, he needed to go. And I was like,
that sucks, man. Stupid. Jango in fucking Revenge of the Sith could have been awesome.
Mm-hmm. Yep, he could have been. I know, stupid. No, but I think he'd take Predator out easily.
Jango,
if he goes invisible, his visor will be able to pick up. He has every sort of capability that Predator has. He can
Predator's
fly.
Plasma caster outplays any of the weaponry that Jango has.
Nah, man, he's got Beskar. Just
Beskar's melting to plasma caster, and it doesn't matter anyway because he's not fully covered in Beskar. And if the Predator's going to be locking onto heat signals, it won't be the Beskar.
So what would happen is he would probably be like, "Okay, this guy's pretty good, so I'm just going to have the Slave One start shooting at him while I like burn him or something like that."
We've watched Jango get his ass kicked a couple times, unfortunately. Like Obi-Wan. Yeah, but he didn't even use the Force in that fight, which honestly, on rewatch, I was kind of confused about that for a moment. I was like, why isn't Obi-Wan fucking him up with the Force? Probably remember he loses the jetpack and they have like a fist fight for a little bit? It's like Obi-Wan could just fucking throw him.
But he was using the Force through all those times. I mean, when you're a Jedi, you're using the Force in perpetuity, especially when he's hitting him with his helmet. He has to be using the Force.
Well, yeah, but throw him, right? Just you want to get him away from you. You don't want to be punching and hitting a guy with armor.
Yeah. I always wondered about that too.
It's tough because when you have a power like the Force. I was thinking about that when I was watching Revenge of the Sith, because when they get stopped by the ray shields, to me it's like fucking Anakin just like literally use telekinesis and fucking crush the power supply that's feeding like those shields. It's hard because it does feel like it's something with unlimited potential and there would always be a way to get out of something.
Yeah. Like the buzz droids, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Obi-Wan should be fucking up those buzz droids.
Like using them with the Force. Yeah, just crush them.
Also, someone is spamming chat right now.
Someone's saying Trump 2024.
Which is very relevant to our discussion of buzz droids.
and then Ninja Turtle right behind him says Penday Joss 2024.
I had to hide you, man. No spam. If you want to post a political thing, you guys can post once. Post it once. Don't spam it. Hail all. I hate to see this show end. SG became one of my top three favorite shows with FNT and Real BBC. You three have a great dynamic. It's like hanging out with friends. Look forward to it coming back when new shows come back. Me too.
Yeah.
There's still a 30% chance of hope, but the more I think about it, it's dwindling. I don't think so.
30% hopefulness. It's like when you start a new Star Wars series, huh?
Now it's like 1% hopefulness. What color lightsaber is best for my hamster, Ryan?
Pink. Red.
Dicks out for the grift. Cheers, gents, to 07. You need to watch Hachiko if you want Ryan to cry.
Chico, I'll avoid it. Thanks.
If you guys haven't, you should really check out the Star Wars Old Republic trailers. Of course, course we have.
Fucking awesome.
Well, up until the newest ones, that one was ass. Newest one? What's the newest one? Oh, with Malgus?
Is the newest one like 7 years old or something?
No.
They just put out new ones?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's I think it's 2 years old. Is it this one? Yeah, it's this one. Yeah, yeah.
Oh yeah, this is yeah, absolutely.
I know it is difficult.
It's with the big fucking like yeah.
If you notice with new Disney Star Wars,
ass, but go ahead.
No, with new Disney Star Wars, every time they use lightsabers now to clash, it's like this big like it's like very bassy. Have you noticed that?
And it's like super, like sparky, I guess.
Yeah, what's with the sparks, dude?
I love this.
Destroy this machine and all records of it.
Yes, Master Moore.
Fucking Malgus.
Malgus. Traitor. Go. Now.
Oh, I totally zoned out, dude.
Shit. Wait, you're just watching?
Yeah, dude, I completely zoned out. I was just like, wait, we're live. Sorry.
Yeah, I didn't mind that one if that was the most recent one.
Yeah, it was great. I love you guys. Best show on the internet. I'm back, Ryan. I'll miss the show. And to all that we're watching, the Vader episode 2 is going to look like this. The fidelity will be the same.
I like how this dude just mentions, I'm black, Ryan. Thank you.
Oh, I thought you said I'm back.
No, he says, I'm black, Ryan.
Oh. Part 1 of 2, Jake the Movie Geek. Ryan, the inhibitor chip arc fixed Order 66 for me. Before, it wasn't believable that every clone would blindly follow that order and that they knew that order even existed. And that they knew Palpatine is a Sith Lord, since throughout the whole movie they address him as my lord. That arc in Clone Wars fixed that for me. Your thoughts?
I hate the inhibitor chips. I kind of despise them. I find it a lot more compelling that these troopers who are literally bred to obey the Republic, not the Jedi, they're bred to obey the Republic, and that despite all these experiences they have with them, when they're given an order, they obey their fucking commands and are forced to do that. I find that a lot more compelling than somebody being literally a fucking robot. They might as well be battle droids if they have a chip in their head. Fuck that.
So the chip stuff, that can't coexist with the 501st storyline in Battlefront 2 then, right?
Correct.
Right, I get what you're saying, yeah. 100%.
Much love for all you do, especially you, Ryan.
Thank you, my cum smells.
What?
My cum smells.
That's his name. You want? Yeah, let me say, Mister. Mister. Come, Mister. My cum smells.
In the middle of reading Death Troopers, one of the most unnerving zombie stories. Mahler, I know you can't read, but use the Force for this one.
Maybe.
I know you can't read, but read.
Yeah, Death Troopers is the only thing I don't like about Death Troopers is that it includes two characters that we know and we love. I won't spoil it for anybody that wants to read it. But I don't like the introduction of those characters because I immediately know, based on when it's set, that those characters are going to survive, which makes it tough to be in a horror zombie kind of mode when you know those characters are going to make it out fine. That's my criticism of that book in general.
Hail to the Grift. I'm almost done with the Last Command. What should I read before getting Hand of Thrawn?
I would read the Jedi Academy trilogy. 100%.
You really like NJO, eh?
NJO is... So, NJO and Onward is like my favorite era of Star Wars. Yeah.
How fast do you think you can go through one book?
If it's a book I've like read before and familiar with, pretty fucking quick. I mean, I could sit down and read. If I had a solid fucking like day of just reading, I could read one of those books in a day. But I never have that kind of time anymore. So yeah. It's tough to guess.
Mahler, you've spoken to Rick Worley since EFAP 84. I think Stargrift viewers would like his Star Wars videos. I recommend him alongside Nerdonymous. Small channel, very detailed, well-researched, and interesting.
I don't think I have, really. He was brought on as sort of the pro-prequels side of a debate that is famously the worst episode of EFAP, I think, to this day. Not his fault. Not anyone's fault in particular. Just the conversation was hilarious. We'll put it that way. And yeah, I think plenty of people have recommended and enjoyed his videos. I think he sort of covers the prequels very positively or goes into details that some people miss and stuff like that.
Should Star Wars Legends be turned into a What If series on Disney Plus? Yeah, why not?
I would be scared. I mean, the idea in principle, yeah.
Man, but, all they gotta do is copy-paste.
Yeah, but they've shown they can't even do that.
I do find it stupid that Maul came back, but I do think that the way he goes out in Rebels, for all its flaws, I find a good end for this chapter. What did you guys think of Luke in Book of Boba Fett 6? Nothing really to think about.
I really enjoyed how much he clearly admired Ahsoka Tano. That was really my favorite part of it, was how he just valued her wisdom and stuff.
Luke Skinwalker, my man. That's what that was.
Pixelated Ryan shirt? What's that?
One stream 5 years ago, almost. My internet or my computer fucking crashed and my entire picture just went like pixelated for like 10 minutes and I couldn't do anything without at least hard resetting.
Mahler, do you know about the Dexter Jetster Jedi who dual wielded double bladed sabers? I mean, Pong Krell? He had two hands for free for the force and saber strikes. Funny AF.
Wow.
Okay. I've never heard him referred to as the Dexter Jetster Jedi, but that's funny. Pretty funny.
Obi-Wan!
It's treason, then.
There he is.
There he is.
Neat.
Well, is that the case for Fat Mace is the chosen one? It's quite possible. Getting fat equals stronger in the Force. The Fat Mace Windu theory looking more probable. Jedi still have to stay in physical shape. Remember what Shadow Vow told Cade Skywalker in the Legacy comic. You're not in bad shape for a bounty hunter. Terrible shape for a Jedi.
Yeah. I mean, physical training is a super important thing that the Jedi do that gets overlooked. I mean, look what fucking Luke, you know, was doing.
Yeah.
Fucking running through the goddamn swamps of Dagobah with Yoda on his back.
Yeah, look at Maul, dude. He's jacked.
Mm-hmm. Well, he never has to, you know, he skips leg day, so.
Word is Keanu has a cameo in Acolyte possible. Possibly as Revan, I'm assuming during a Sith history explanation. Maybe this super was read when streamed down. No, it's being read now. Being read now. Yeah, I mean, Keanu being in the Acolyte would be cool. Maybe it was a hologram or some shit. It was great meeting you in Orlando Theory. Glad you liked George Stormtrooper. It was great meeting you too. What do y'all think of a Band of Brothers style Clone Trooper Stormtrooper series? Sad to see the stream go. Love you guys. I mean, like troops?
Sure. You could do it. I don't think they will.
I feel like Bad Batch was like...
Yeah, but like good though.
Yeah, exactly. I feel like that was kind of the goal. That's what I assumed the goal of Bad Batch was originally until I realized it's a backdoor to work in cloning Palpatine. But... Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I will do what I must. Qui-Gon. Yeah, Qui-Gon was the first to say that. If you had to choose between keeping only Star Wars canon or expanded universe, what would you keep? OG movies gone, but so would be Disney's Star Wars. The OG movies are the best, dude. I can't. You can't get rid of those.
Because without those movies, the rest of the books mean nothing. Although, like, if you're telling me how much more time did I spend enjoying like in my fucking life, probably more in the expanded universe, just because there's so much other than like 2 hour movies. Yeah. But you can't take it away though.
No, can't put more girls in the show so you guys can.
Thanks, Kathleen.
How much for the manifesto, Ryan? Please and thanks.
Oh, you want it? That's what you wanted. You wanted me to read that fucking.
He's saying give him a price, dude.
Well, he already super chatted, right? What the fuck? Is that the Nemec manifesto or whatever?
That's he's the one. He's got
to take Salacious out to dinner tonight, so you know.
He doesn't eat much. Other than dick. Let me see. Hold on. All right. In an Omega voice?
Yeah, I guess.
Is this the right one? This is posted to the Star Wars and or Reddit.
You don't have to.
No, probably is. I guess. Still...
There will be times when the struggle seems impossible. I know this already. Alone, unsure, dwarfed by the scale of the enemy. Remember this. Freedom is a pure idea, Batcha. It occurs spontaneously and without instruction. Random acts of insurrection are occurring constantly throughout the galaxy. There are whole armies, battalions that have no idea they've already enlisted in the cause, like Crosshair. Remember, the frontier of the rebellion is everywhere, and even the smallest act of insurrection pushes our lines forward. And remember this. The imperial need for control is so desperate because it is so unnatural. Tyranny requires constant effort. It breaks, it leaks, like Wrecker's brain. Authority is brittle. Oppression is the mask of fear. Remember that and know this. One day the day will come when all these skirmishes and battles, these moments of defiance, will have flooded the banks of the Empire's authority. And then there will be one too many. One single thing will break the siege. Remember this. Try. There you go. That's beautiful. Beautiful.
Inspiring.
Yeah. There it is.
Can we get you guys best unlimited power to close out the Glorious Grift? No. Forrest Gump has it coming, boys. Long, girthy analysis coming this summer. Not all bad, though. Don't hate the guy that much. The script is the villain.
Okay.
I've never met somebody who hated Forrest Gump as much as you.
It's been a good ride, gentlemen. Thank you for the optimism during the dark times, Theory. See you on Open Bar, Mahler.
See ya.
Thoughts on the OG Willow movie? It's Ryan's favorite.
Yeah, it's all right.
Well, it's fine. I'm not like I was never attached to it as a child or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Serrano ham, Asiago cheese, pickled red onions, horseradish on rosemary, rime, ciabatta bread. We got sharp flavors here, boys.
Holy fuck. You guys are fancy as shit.
Yeah, you guys are fancy as hell, man. My sandwiches as a kid was like a piece of ham with some cheese.
Yeah.
What are each of your top 100 planets in Star Wars? Go fuck yourself.
Thanks, Darth Shanae.
Serrano ham is also my favorite Jedi. Mahler, pretend you know nothing about the Clone Wars at all. What would you want a series with that premise to do in terms of characters and storytelling?
We would be going heavy into how the clones work, and I would probably want to work within it from like a sense of if they all believe in the Empire and they are all genetically modified to be persuaded to, you know, some, not like the robotic sense, but certainly trained to be biased in a particular direction. I would really want to explore like the ones that, you know, how they could be trained for like particular purposes. And so you'll have ones that are meant for commanding and leadership and creative thinking for war. So they would be higher ranks, but you could also have like a backdoor accidental repercussion that those ones are the ones that creatively think to the point of not agreeing with a lot of the Empire's main positions, and so you can then create splinter forces everywhere that those ones lead groups that are either completely against or want to leave, or, you know, ones that literally are just like, I don't want to be a part of this. And I know there's a lot of people saying right now, it's like, isn't that what Clone Wars covers? And I'd be like, probably not in the way that I'm thinking. I would want it to be a lot more, probably a lot more darker, a lot more serious. I quite love the darkest tones of Revenge of the Sith. And then, of course, that's just the clone side of it. I want the expansion of, like, everything during the Clone Wars. I want to know a hell of a lot more about the Separatists and all of their motivations and how they came together. I want Saruman-level speeches from Count Dooku. I want him rallying systems. I want him to have really good points and positions. I want him to actually have a public debate at some point with someone and absolutely fucking wrecks them on, like, the Republic being a decadent, broken system that's destroying everything. Like, I have infinite ideas that I would love to see, and I doubt, especially with what Ryan tells me fucking every other day, like, I doubt that Clone Wars will fill that hole for me.
It might. Gotta watch it. Rack ghoul disease or 171A bioweapon? What's worse?
Dude, I don't want to be a fucking rack ghoul. Fuck those things, man. KOTOR.
Yeah, I'm not reading that, Rossi. It makes no sense. Thanks for the fun streams, boys. Glad to have been introduced to Ryan and Mahler. Lots of fun laughs and new insights. Thanks for all the hard work that you all do. Oh, thank you, Matt.
Thank you.
Nice thank you, Mr. Boardman.
Matt also worked on episode 2. This show helped me fall in love with Star Wars again. Started watching for Mahler and Ryan. Now I'm a Theory super fan. See you after Acolyte. Hey, right on, dude. Thanks.
Nice.
That's cool. We
Delivery
like...
man Q. Yeah, we got a lot of cross-pollination going on.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Indeed. Dave is not all we have. Stop saying that BS. Okay, who else we got? Jay?
Gilroy.
Tony Gilroy.
Fuck Tony Gilroy.
Why fuck him?
unless there's a Mary kill other
didn't,
people.
Didn't he say that, like, oh, half the time I forgot I was making a Star Wars project?
It's yeah, like, but when you watch it, you know what he's talking about is that he's so focused on the character's storylines that it could be placed in a way in anything. But that's like any good storytelling you want present in any particular IP. You want it to work. You want the characters to start, finish, and develop in a particular way. Like, you can fall into just the character itself and forget, like, oh yeah, this is in the world of Star. This is in the world of, you know, Darth Vader and Obi-Wan and Yoda and Death Stars and stuff. It's like, yeah, you can forget that when you're in the nitty-gritty of some person in the middle of, like, some distant planet trying to hide from, you know, some person fair building enough about whatever.
That's a good explanation, but I think it also would be important to make sure you keep in mind that it is Star Wars, so that you can, in any sort of scenario where something needs to blend to the galaxy, you are doing that and you're cognizant of it. Otherwise, it's just ends up feeling like some sort of sci-fi Blade Runner thing, like, which is what
I was happier with the way the Empire is portrayed in that than I have been in anything else to do with Disney Star Wars.
I know you are.
That's what I'm saying, though. It's like that is a connective piece to Star Wars that I like to consider canon. I think that they're very powerful and organized.
Would you say that's the only Disney canon that you would consider?
Of what I have seen, we're throwing out the sequels, obviously. Throwing out Solo. Yeah, those are out. I think we throw out Rogue One.
Would you?
But Andor I'd really happily keep.
I would say for me, Disney canon, that's like actual canon in my mind, would be Tales of the Jedi, Rogue One, Andor, Clone Wars Season 7.
Not Mandalorian?
I'm throwing that the fuck out.
Mandalorian Season 1 and 2. Not 3. Not Book of Boba Fett.
Rebels?
Ahsoka, sure, why not? Yeah, Rebels, yeah, okay.
Don't Ahsoka, include sure. Ahsoka.
What else we got going on?
Burn literally everything to the ground. That's how I feel.
I already knew that would be your answer.
Yeah, don't keep anything.
I mean, hey, if we have that option, yeah, burn it all to the ground and redo it. Please.
Not even redo it. Just burn it to the ground and
leave it alone.
And yeah, never make another Star Wars property again. That's preferable to me rather than continue with what we have.
What if George were to come back and be like, all right, I own it again.
Ain't coming back, man.
Fictitious.
In a fictitious world where even though 12 years ago, George didn't want to make movies, but he comes back now at the ripe old age of 80 when he can barely walk. If he comes back, go ahead.
Theories, hypothetical would just be George, in a capacity to be able to create them, I assume is what you're going for.
Yeah. Then I would say absolutely. Let me see more. 100%.
Chat sounds like Yoda.
He is too old. Too old to make the films.
He is.
He is.
Yeah.
He felt like he was too old 12 years ago, you know? That's just the reality.
Yeah, but that was a mistake. I think he made a mistake.
Well,
he's still kicking, man. He's still around. George needs to stop drinking Coca-Cola and like take some stem cells or something, man. Like,
what the fuck is the point of life if you can't drink shit that's not good for you?
At least, I don't know, take some stem cells or something.
Obviously some baby blood.
Yeah, eat a baby umbilical cord.
maybe not that.
Somebody needs to Photoshop a baby umbilical cord on the tray for when he was in that Australia food court. Just sitting there. So we need a Photoshop of that.
The fucking bloodboard umbilical cords.
George extending his life to come back to save Star Wars.
George is
theory in an emperor outfit, just being like, yes, yes.
At least one YouTube video will be made with this theory in mind.
Yes.
It's happening.
He's like animates. He's like, why did you do this?
You must be brought back.
I don't want this shit anymore.
I have died before.
Have y'all seen the animated versions of The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings? Oh yeah, I've seen clips. I haven't seen the whole thing.
I remember watching The Hobbit one. That was from like the 60s or something, right?
They're old.
Yeah.
I remember that one. I don't know if I ever...
I am old, the filmmakers. What's your favorite Disney Trooper design? Disney Trooper? None. I like Shock Troopers and the 501st. That's not Disney.
Disney Trooper.
I love the Zombie Troopers the best. They're my favorite.
I like how they have random red wrappings.
Ryan.
Oh, so cool, dude.
Ryan loves that. Ryan loves the red Sith Troopers from Rise of Skywalker.
Oh, they were
so cool. They were red.
Yeah.
That means bad because the bad guys have red lightsabers.
The Final Order, which is so clever because the other guys were known as the First Order.
Love you guys. Wish you the best individually. What would you three think about X-Men 97? I haven't seen it.
I only watched the first episode. Yeah, I only saw the first episode, and so it's a little too early to make a decision. The animation's a little wonky, voice acting's a little wonky. I feel like the story is about to take a turn. But again, I haven't even watched episode 2 yet. So I probably will watch the entire season, though.
Pendejos is my second favorite Jedi. Pendejos. What force power does Cornhorn have? Seem to recall it was an unusual in reading. I, Jedi, but cannot remember. Fantastic book, by the way.
Yeah, so what is the fucking name of it? It's basically the ability to absorb and convert energy.
He's like Sebastian Shaw from First Class.
So it's God, there's a fucking very specific name for it. You remember the Old Republic trailer where Satele Shan stops the lightsaber with her hand and is like absorb it? That's what it is.
Tutuminous,
that's it. Thank you. Yeah. He's super skilled in Tutuminous, but he can't he's not gifted telekinetically. Unless he is like kind of superpowered level, absorbed a lot of energy, then he can use telekinesis.
What's more powerful, Ryan's lust for Salacious Crumb or his fidelity to Brie Larson? Something's got to give.
Bro, I would murder Salacious Crumb if Brie Larson married me.
Obi-Wan Kenobi said the Force penetrates us, so how could it possibly be female? I'm straight actress Michael...
Michaela digs that ass.
I want Theory's take on if grapes are weird olives.
Well,
I don't even get that.
No,
not. Simple yes or no question. Yeah.
No, they're totally different. One's sugary, one's oily.
Well, this is weird.
They are weird.
No,
I think olives are weird grapes.
There you go.
That's my take.
I mean, you can make wine from grapes. You can't make wine from olives. Can you?
You can make olive wine. Oil.
Olive wine. Mm-hmm. Question for Ryan, Theory, and I guess Mahler. I guess. Is it ever explained how Yoda knew of the Rule of Two? Also, what should I read before DP? Thank you for the best streams ever. Wish you all well, and I guess Mahler too. Love you, Mahler.
Hello.
If you're asking about Darth Plagueis, you don't really need to read anything before it. That's when you can, as long as you've seen the prequels, you can hop right into it.
I wish there was a prequel to Darth Plagueis, man. It, like, talks about Tenebris.
That, like, the most useful prequel to Darth Plagueis will be the Bane trilogy, to be honest. And that takes place 1,000 years before.
Like so far
but it sets up the Rule of Two. And that's really the only other thing that would apply. In terms of how Yoda knew,
I mean,
I may have forgotten a story or something. I don't know. There was at one point in time a moment when, well, we do know this. We do know that the Jedi sent a strike force to try to kill Bane. And they were basically tricked into thinking that they killed him. They thought that they killed Bane. And maybe that's when they thought they ended the line. Obviously, Yoda has access to 900 years worth of knowledge from the Jedi archives. There was a story at one point about a Sith who tried to turn back to the Jedi and the Order, and like they almost got fucking wiped out because of it. Maybe that's how. I don't recall right now. I don't know. I don't know.
I mean, he's lived for a long time, so I would imagine that, you know, during his maybe research or dark times, he probably saw some sort of a hologram, holocron with, you know, Revan or something. Can we expect commemorative Stargriff plushies? Probably not anymore. Mahler,
imagine if we released that like 6 months from now.
Why not? Mahler, I've been playing video games for 30 years. Argument destroyed for story in video games. All right.
Which one?
It's like all of them. It's called Atari. Member for 6 months. What's up, nerd dumb? 3v3, who wins? Mace, Anakin, Yoda versus Dooku, Maul, Sidious.
Shit.
It's a tough one.
I mean, I would say Yoda, Anakin, Mace.
Fuck, that's tough, dude.
Let's be real. Padawan Obi-Wan Kenobi ended up defeating fucking Maul. Okay?
Yeah, but...
Anakin took out Dooku.
Really,
I don't think we should go by that as, like, the definitive one is better than the other. Because...
Yeah. I know.
Just if they're all...
matchups and things, right? Obviously, fucking Dooku beat Anakin and Obi-Wan at the same time. Then a couple years later, he got fucking his hands cut off right before his fucking head.
Sidious,
his powers have doubled since they last met.
If those two are distracted, man, I think Sidious would just it's easy game. He just kills everyone.
I wonder if the fact that it's a 3v3 changes it as well in terms of how well these three work with each other.
It doesn't, because it would literally be a 1v5. Sidious doesn't care about Dooku and Maul. He would just use them as body shields.
Yeah, but that still does count as to whether or not which team would win, right?
I think any team with Sidious would win.
Nah, Sidious fucking went toe-to-toe with Yoda, ends up beating him. I could see a situation where Yoda fucking wins that fight. Like, I don't think he's, like, out-fucking-classed by Sidious at all.
No.
Well, I mean, he practically lost that fight because he fell back. They both fell back, and one of them had a worse fall. Like,
exactly.
That's it.
So,
so
I just think that...
It's like a street fight where you stumble over a rock, and it's like in Troy, like, get up, Prince of Troy, I'm not going to let a rock take my glory.
Hmm.
It was like that.
Yeah, so that's why I feel like it's not super, like, outmatched, just because Sidious is on one team.
And what Anakin are we dealing with here as well? Because does the character come into play here as opposed to just their skill?
Let's do episode 3.
Because if it was episode 3 Anakin... Probably if you plucked him from when he kills Dooku, like that sort of Anakin.
Yep, that moment.
Then, yeah, you've got a lot of power on their side. But, I mean, you know, Mace and Yoda, they have some feelings toward Anakin, you know? Meanwhile, Dooku, Maul, and Sidious, I could see them being pretty unified on just wiping out the other three.
I'd say so. Ryan 2024,
Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
Real talk, I'm going to miss this a lot. Love you guys. Love you too. I don't know if you agree with me, but I think the only way to salvage Star Wars is to adapt the Legends timeline into a What If series on Disney Plus. Yeah, I'm down for that. What's up, Atten? Turn 27 tomorrow. Advice, guys, to have a great year. Just follow your dreams, be true to yourself, work hard, and be healthy.
Find a loose woman.
A loose woman?
Yep.
Loose? Yeah, like those lightsaber whips.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyone else confused on how Anakin in Ahsoka works? If you can pull anyone into the world between worlds, why not just do it to Sheev?
Just kill him. he's planning out everything like a young Sheev. Then Anakin just goes, hey.
it's like, what's up? It's like, ah.
Yeah, World Between Worlds is fucking retarded.
That is.
And nobody knows how it works because it was intentionally vague.
Yeah. Because
some people think that makes it seem smart. You don't explain yourself because you have no fucking idea how it works.
What's up, happy console gamer? Ryan and Mahler, I will pay to make up for 30% if you guys keep the collab going. Theory, I was asking about a custom hilt if it's possible. If you were serious about a cancer awareness sale, I work in a hospital. It wouldn't really make to make one, I would have to make at least 200. That's how the factory works. So I'd need an MOQ, a minimum order quantity of at least 200. So let's say the saber, I don't know, what's it going to cost? $300, $400, $200. You know, that's a minimum of $40,000. Right up there for one saber, right? It just doesn't make sense to do a one-off. So I would have to do a whole bunch to at least make the money back. And then, you know, you're putting a portion of it into charity. So it's, you'd have to look at all the numbers and see like how it's possible. It's just right now, it's not really something that I can afford. So, yeah, I'd love to do it, but I mean, it would probably be down the line.
As for the making up thing, is like, I love the passion, appreciate everyone's investment in the show, but like, it's really not down to the money. I would happily do it as a fun thing that we do if I had the time. Like, if it was no way we could make money from this, I wouldn't be opposed to doing it. It's just not going to work scheduling wise.
What do you think of the name Sheev?
It's funny. Oh,
funny name. Theory 2 and 2 is not balanced. Dark side is bad. Got a question about Vader. Do you need CGI concept artists for this film? Would love to join the team someday, whether that's Vader or next. Right now, we're good. We got everyone that we need. They're all around the world working. And, you know, we'll pick up new artists every month. Drop them, new artists. Because people go off to the other projects and stuff, so. We got a great flow going. Appreciate you requesting. Theory, do you meet up in Toronto? Sure, I could one day. Never been to Toronto.
I was going to say, isn't Toronto like a long-ass way away from you?
5 hours.
Oh, that's not that bad. Okay.
It's like Florida. Florida's six.
Well,
Disney should.
Wait, you're talking about flying, right?
You're flying, yeah.
Okay. Toronto's like on East Coast, though.
Yes.
All right.
Disney should just go full SJW and embrace the Force's female and have a rainbow-haired 500-pound woman wielding a red whip saber in drag.
It'd be pretty cool. Have her fight Vader in the World Between Worlds.
Yeah.
Don't give him good ideas.
And then it wraps around the saber in his neck, and then he says, I'm sorry, and then the helmet pops off and he's crying.
Who's your daddy? And then, yeah, the helmet pops off, and then his head falls off.
Mm-hmm.
And then Maul appears.
And then he cries and says he's sorry as well.
Yeah, yeah, he says, I'm sorry too.
Hi from set. Just a fellow fan filmmaker here. Right on.
What's up?
Gina Carano's supposed to be at PhillyCon. Want to go bad, but I'll have my son, and I heard there will be protesters. Do they keep them outside?
There ain't going to be anybody protesting. You don't have to worry about it.
Yeah, go see her, man.
There'll be like, if there is, it'll be maybe two people that are probably 600 pounds combined that have weird colored hair, and they'll have masks on, and they'll be holding up like misspelled signs. You have nothing to worry about from that shit.
Gizatron. He said, I'm Black Ryan, not I'm Black Ryan.
Oh, maybe he said he's Black Me. Is that, comma.
Big into fitness and have always tried my best to imagine what kind of physical training the Jedi do. Lifting to Jedi Temple March music goes hard. It sure does. You should try Duel of the Fates. What company do you trust with Star Wars instead of Disney? None, really, to be honest with you. No company. I meant to say that I'm Black, to say I don't think he's racist. I love the show.
Hell yeah. I knew what you meant.
You should.
Hell yeah.
You should tweet it, Ryan. This show helped cure my depression and helped me reconnect with my children. That's probably over now. I get it. Y'all are busy. So, hey, I'm still available. Don't put it on me, man.
The fuck?
I'm trying to make it as lucrative as I can for them.
You can get triple. It didn't exist before. Now it does. And now you can watch all three of us in our corners of the internet giving you triple the anti-depression and reconnection. Isn't that great?
Sucks the show's going to end. Love listening to you guys. I mean, I will volunteer as tribute to ensure the show goes on. Also, thanks. Thanks, Dan. Well, you know, let me hit them with the proposition after. And it's maybe they'll... I don't know. What figures... Ryan, what figures are next to Revan on the desk?
What? Over here? So this is Gina Carano. This is Darth Nihilus. This is Jaina Solo. And that's Darth Revan as opposed to the Jedi Revan.
So no Darth Maul, huh? All right.
No.
It's fine.
Why did Yoda and Obi-Wan send baby Luke to two random strangers out of nowhere when they never even met them? Only Anakin and Padme met them in episode 2. No relationship in prequel trilogy whatsoever. Because at least of anyone that they'd send them, at least those people would probably be a good candidate.
It does have some connection to his family.
Yeah.
I mean, I think this goes back to the OT as well. There's kind of an issue. I'm not sure it makes complete sense, the plan to hide on Tatooine with...
On his birthplace, yeah.
Yeah, not the greatest idea. Like, probably better places to hide him. I think that's a result of like different story ideas moving around until they'd finally settled on what they were doing, right?
Rogue One is Andor. If you try to cram Andor into 3 episodes, kind of.
I don't remember Rogue One being as strong as Andor in its non-action segments. You know what I mean?
I thought Rogue One was fucking dog shit until the last 20 minutes. Mm. And then the last 2 minutes when Vader showed up went all fucking crazy.
Garfield's Bizarre Adventure says, my Hollywood sources have assured me that the Acolyte trailer is fake, Leslie Headland is actually fired, and George is buying back Star Wars. Oh, that'd be nice.
Sweet.
I feel like I've heard rumors like that before.
Ryan, what's your favorite and least favorite Harry Potter book? Oh, good question.
My favorite switches between... Goblet of Fire and Half-Blood Prince. My least favorite is probably Order of the Phoenix. I don't hate it or anything like that, but that was probably like my least favorite one that came out while I was reading them. And ironically, it's one of the movies that I enjoy more because I didn't love the book.
What would your Kenobi series premise look like?
It would look like the book where Obi-Wan is in hiding. He doesn't go off planet to fucking save Leia or some shit. He's doing his job watching over Luke. And he's trying to stay out of the way.
The Obi-Wan book.
Yeah, exactly. Yet he continues to kind of get drawn into things and his instincts are still to help people. And so very low level, some random fucking village and they've got a problem with Tusken Raiders and Obi-Wan reluctantly gets involved. And then also in the middle of all that, you have Obi-Wan trying to do what he said he would do and, you know, connect and talk to Qui-Gon, but also dealing with his feelings of failure as a master, as a brother, as a father, like all these ways that he feels like he's failed Anakin and may in fact think he's dead.
Stargriff merch when? Kill for a hoodie. I mean, we can make something eventually. Do you guys know of the comic where Jar Jar's dad nearly ended it in Minecraft when all he had left was his son? What?
I don't remember that.
Sad to see this end. I really liked you guys' dynamic. Mahler, when are you going to finally continue Arkham Gaming series? The Force
Awakens.
That's another thing, like I mentioned last week, I've ran out of time for like gaming streams. I'll try and fit one in at some point for sure, though, because I do want to get through them.
If the Star Wars universe was real and you were born into it, what would you do? How would you live your life? Bonus, you have high midichlorian count. Question for all three of you. I would live my life the way I feel like.
Bounty Hunter, probably. It's just too much fun.
Yeah, I would use the dark side of the Force, and I would not care about the state of the galaxy. I would only care about living as well as I could, fucking as many people as I could, fuck everything else.
Especially Salacious Crumb.
You should probably go to Jabba's palace, force choke Jabba, and be like, come with me, Salacious.
Bro, Jedi can control their blood flow, man.
Well, there you go, cheat codes.
Mm-hmm. just got that. So I don't know, man. I'd just be good to people, and then
wouldn't.
You double cross me, you know, you'd see you later. That's it.
I'd make everybody be good to me. No out mercy. Of fear. I'd be like how Boba Fett should have fucking been in his show.
I'd be nice. I'd be nice to everyone, but treat people as they treat you. So if someone's a dick, then they're see ya. Bye bye. You're dead. Simple as that. Whereas Ryan, I think, would just be like, no, I don't like you.
Pretty much. Him.
Hey, Theory, just out of curiosity, when you make fanfic videos, are they all your original ideas, or do you take some that are requested to you? Because I have made Star Wars fanfictions. They're on Archive of Our Own under author name Creed_Nation. Say 99% of them are my own. Some of them are fan requests.
Is that Archive of Our Own?
No, Archive.
Archive of Our Own.
Hey boys, how about a Villeneuve made Revan movie?
He wouldn't do it. He doesn't want to do pre-existing film franchise stuff. But I like him as a filmmaker.
Saw Quiet on the Set, made me sick. Still can't believe pervs and pedos are still employed by Disney and Nick. What will it take to fix the system? What's Quiet on Set?
It's the four-part documentary about the Dan Schneider, like, use of power to manipulate people in both sexual ways and sort of general ways. Some of the stuff I didn't know about was he would like dare people to do things and promise to pay them and then not do that, or at least things that were like that. There's too many examples of that throughout all of Hollywood for it to not be a very significant systemic problem they need to fucking deal with. And it's just a matter of people get to be so powerful when they were never expecting it. And then they get to pull strings and they enjoy it too much to stop.
And like, when people are away from their parents.
Yeah, there's not
supervision. Yeah.
It's probably better today than it ever has been. But like when you go back to late 90s and then go all the way back to 70s and stuff, it's just like, yeah, the further back, the less protection there is and the more wild everything fucking is. We've had loads of exposed stories in different ways, but I've only seen the first episode of 4, and so far it's not fun to watch, as you'd
expect.
Seems
to be a very prevalent thing in Hollywood.
Yeah.
We have a George Lucas meme.
We do?
Mm-hmm.
How would you all take Republic Commando? What's the meme?
Where? I'm sharing it.
Oh. My mistake.
There's George with apparently an umbilical cord.
Sweet.
All right.
So, thank you for that, Mo Zamboni. That was quick turnaround. Well, whatever works.
I wish George has another 500 years of life. Healthy, happy life.
That's going to be a lot of umbilical cords.
How would you all like a Republic Commando sequel? Maybe an Imperial Commando game? Disney would never. I would love that. Remember how they said they need to focus on games and then they stopped focusing on games? Filoni raised Ahsoka. All right.
Ooh.
Oh. Theory, can you do a fan meetup in Alert Nunavut? I mean, that'd be hilarious if I literally just hopped on a plane tomorrow to go there for that one super chat. That'd be actually pretty cool. I'm Black, and Ryan has my fave takes on Stargrift. Theory, please do more collabs with him in the future. I'd love to, man. They're busy. Ryan is a certified expert. Jason Solo for the win. I'd love to, man. I'd love to keep the show going. I'm pulling out all the stops.
Thank you, J-Man.
To keep the boys happy. In my opinion, I think it's pathetic that some people call George Lucas a sellout because he backs Iger and Proxy Fight. Bunch of flip-flopping.
I saw a lot of people that were like attacking and say, fuck you. And it's like, come on, man. Like, again, I took issue with one thing in his statement, which was clearly like a PR fucking drafted thing. But I get it.
Yeah. This feels like It 1 and Disney is Pennywise. What do you guys think of the theory that Dark Fallen Jedi can never be as strong in the dark side as true Sith? Maybe because tainted by the light? Yeah, maybe not as strong, but different.
Yeah, I don't think they can fully like embrace the dark side quite as much like as like, can Sith they use force are heal? Able to.
Can they use Force Heal?
I don't know.
That'd be kind of cool. Maybe you could use both powers. Theory, what's your take on people attacking you over your opinion on the Red Saber continuity in The Acolyte? Are people attacking me?
What's your opinion of the Red Saber continuity?
What do you mean, continuity?
But I don't know.
That's a question, yeah.
Like,
the question was your opinion on Red Saber continuity and Acolyte.
Well, I think anyone that sees a Red Saber should be axed. Like, see you later.
Oh, you're saying like if you see anyone with a red lightsaber, you need to take them out?
Yeah, absolutely.
Wait, no. What you're saying is if any Jedi sees someone who has a red lightsaber, they need to be killed. Otherwise, it's canon breaking.
Yep.
That's what you mean, right? I agree with like the intention of like what you said. The only thing I'll say is not necessarily every single person we have ever seen with a red lightsaber is a Sith, but I think it's pretty fair to say that the assumption matter. That you're talking about is if they know that it's a Sith.
It doesn't matter if it's a Sith or not. It's anything other than yellow, green, blue, you know, the purple. So the Jedi are going to be like, what the fuck is this? This is an evil color. Okay, cool. Are they a Sith? It doesn't matter. It's irrelevant. They're using the dark side.
Yeah, certainly they would like track them down. But like, for instance, who is the guy from Jedi Survivor? The one-armed fuck.
Oh, Dagon Arrow.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, he had a red lightsaber. He wasn't a Sith.
Yeah, he wasn't so, a like, Sith, but he was evil. So it doesn't matter if they're part of the Sith cult or not. These people they're so stupid if they're actually trying to fight. I post my stuff and I disappear. I just post it on Twitter and I go, I'm not there to engage with people like take shots at me for nothing. But
yeah, the point of that
debate anything. I just think it's ridiculous that if a Jedi were to see anyone with a red lightsaber, they know that this person is using a aspect of the Force that is not the light side. So clearly, something is weird there. Whether
and they would Sith investigate it and try to hunt it down.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. So okay, you know, the Sith haven't returned in a million. A Darksider returned. Okay. Well, it's the same fucking thing. It's the same exact thing. They don't have to be loyal to the Sith cult or the Rule of Two. You just have to be using the dark side. And that's... It's not like Ki-Adi Mundi's like, well, they're not a Sith per se, but, you know, same fucking thing for Maul. Maul wasn't a Sith. He was a Sith assassin, because at the time, Plagueis and Palpatine were the ones that were part of Rule of Two. And Plagueis and Palpatine always saw Maul as not as a Sith Lord, but as a tool, as a Sith assassin, as a Jedi assassin.
So, and they bullshitted him. They told him a bunch of bullshit to make him feel like he was part of it. Literally. But they never
considered
him.
You're part of the club, but you know what? You're not actually. So you're expendable. We're just using you as a tool. And so right then and there, you could basically see Ki-Adi Mundi's words as kind of null and void because, you know what? Maul isn't a Sith. So how about that? He's just a guy with a red lightsaber who's evil. Literally, that's what he is, to be honest. He's been trained in the ways of the dark side. I mean... You know, people want to debate Star Wars with me on that. Like, man, like, it's your funeral. No problem. That's interesting. I didn't know people were... I saw the numbers were pretty high, and I'm like, oh, it's got good traction. But I didn't know people were actually arguing about it. I started the Clone Wars to see if Mauler might like it. It breaks space battles and the Force in the first couple of episodes. I now believe that the current Star Wars nonsense partially the fault of the Jedi. The Clone Wars.
What do you think about that, Ryan?
I actually do think that the lack of care towards continuity in TCW led to... Now, I don't know if it's at Lucasfilm or not, but I do feel like the lack of care of continuity, even within the movies to the Clone Wars, I think we're seeing a lot of that now from even people that were there at Lucasfilm, like Dave Filoni, and what they're continuing to do with Star Wars. So I do agree.
Balance of the Force is just that, equal. Two Jedi, two Sith.
Really? I disagree with that. I would say that the balance in the Force is the absence of darkness.
Yeah, that's what
the absence of chaos. That's what balance is. Because, I mean, you know, when Anakin is the chosen one, he restores balance to the Force. That is not done until he throws the Emperor over the fucking edge. That's when he restores balance.
True.
It's when all darkness is out of the galaxy. Not true, because there's one and one.
Yeah, but Ryan, something. But Luke exists, and then Palpatine already transferred his essence into his Exegol body. So it's one and one, bro.
Well,
that's canon.
But the thing is, it's not even two and two, and that's the reason I hate that argument. Because the first person I heard say that,
I'm fucking with you.
I know, but like the two and two thing is nonsensical, because in that same time frame, there's still like a multitude of Jedi that are living and doing shit.
Yeah, I know.
Including one of them, Kanan Jarrus, Freddie Prinze Jr.'s retarded ass. When he first gave that analogy, he forgot to count the character that he literally fucking plays. Yeah. But I guess it makes sense, because he said he learned everything he knows from Dave Filoni. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Remember? Two and fucking two. Yeah.
Exactly. Hey,
good job, Freddie Prinze. Awesome. Real good way to talk to fans. Love you guys in the show. Been watching Theory and Mahler for a while, but this show introduced me to Ryan, who I'm also sub to now. We'll be watching all three of you individually from now on. Awesome.
Thanks, Epic Austin.
Sweet.
Salacious bum. Gonna miss you guys together. Hope to see all of you at New York Comic Con next year or this year. Hey, Theory, after your Vader series is done, what's another character you would make a fan film about? I wouldn't, because I'm never going to be dumping $1 million plus into a fan film that I can't make money from ever again. So I will never, ever, 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 ever make another fan film. Ever. It's too expensive. But it would probably be young Palpatine. Where would you guys rank the Star Wars shows?
Low.
Non-existent. Unfortunately, the Imperial Commando game would be only on Tantus. Every mission you try to catch Omega. Every mission you...
If you did an Imperial Commando game, that'd be funny.
What do you think is a better villain? Who do you think is a better villain? Sion or Nihilus? Personally, I think Sion is more believable, even though he is dead. Nihilus seems inconsistent.
Nihilus is very much just like a powerful force entity with no personality. You know what I mean? That's not super interesting. Kreia is the one that brings that game together.
Yeah. Sion's cool, though. He just doesn't die.
Yeah, Sion's just a rage monster. Nihilus is just a fucking force monster. And Kreia is the one that like the mastermind behind everything.
I've been a fan of Mahler and Theory for years. So Stargriff was a welcome surprise while it lasted. Also, thanks for the intro to my new fave, racist Ryan.
Jeez. Thank you. Thank you very much, Sajid. Sahid? I don't know how to say that.
What if Kirak in Fila had received a vision of Order 66 and decided to go to Jedi Temple to warn them? He arrived as Jedi Temple is attacked. He'd still get nerfed. Still get destroyed. The dark times of Palpatine's empire was balancing the Force for Theory. I didn't say that. I didn't say that at all. Everybody sucks except for Mahler.
Oh my god, right. True.
Well. That marks the end of the Super Chats and the end of this show. We appreciate you guys. We had a lot of fun. I'm still going to try to talk to the boys, but, you know, slim chance. Cross your fingers. Cross your toes. Cross your salacious B crumbs.
Oh, man.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, we had a great time.
Get me excited.
We love you guys. You know, this is the closeout to, I guess, the show will be returning a few times a year at the end of every series. And we'll do, you know, a good stream, good live stream, but,
we're going to be doing some events, some specials. Stargriff will be more special. It'd be like a McRib.
Don't forget the movies.
Short-lived, but I mean, I think it had the biggest impact. It had more views than any podcast I've done here in such a dead time of Star Wars. I imagine, you know, what it's going to be when we come back for End of Acolyte and, you know, Ahsoka and Andor and all that. But
I mean, people are gonna like Stargriff specials, you know.
Yeah, really. I'm still gonna pitch the boys a couple ideas at the end, and we'll see what happens. But for now, the show is done. This is the final conclusion. We love you guys. We appreciate you. If we could get one final big like on the stream, that'd mean a lot. It'd be cool. One final hurrah. So we appreciate you guys. Thanks so much for the super chats. Thanks so much for joining in and being part of the Stargriff. And we'll see you guys on social media as well as all of our other social media channels, or into individual channels. And we'll be returning sometime soon.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you all very much. It was
it's been
fun ride.
Yeah. It's been fun and will continue to be fun.
Mm-hmm.
Stargriff reunion specials.
I tagged all the boys in their channels in the description so you can go and check it out. And we'll see you guys next time.
Cheers.
Love see you. Ya.
Later.
With Theory and Mauler.
What's the situation?
And you're sounding like a separatist.